Winnego Pizza presents SCP. The Steve Dangle Podcast with your hosts, Steve Dangle and Adam Wilde.
Gentlemen, I want to start the show with a clip. Whoa, okay, Jesse's throwing stuff at Steve. Threw a puck at Steve. That's a good way to go.
Because friendship.
But, you know, in honor of what happened with the Washington Capitals on Saturday night, I would like to play.
Oh, yes.
Mitch Murder to Matt Martin.
Excellent.
That was awesome. Who tweeted that out?
Modern Nan, at Modern Nan NL, both from the East Coast. Mitch Murder to Matt Martin.
And
you know what
I'm
gonna say?
The second that goal happened, I was like, everyone find an East Coaster and get them to say that out loud.
I never thought in my life I'd see Matt Martin on a breakaway.
Hey, there he was, and he buried it. He buried the thing. It reminded me a few years ago, I want to say, you know what? I think it was against Martin Brodeur and the New Jersey Devils.
Never heard of them.
You see a blue and white jersey get a breakaway and you're like, oh! And then I saw it was Colton Orr and I went, oh! And then he snipes on Martin Brodeur. I'm like, whoa!
You know, honestly, I was terrible at hockey, but whenever I was on a breakaway, I always found that the net looked the smallest when I was on a breakaway. So I'm always blown away by these guys, and obviously the NHL players, they should be pretty damn good at it.
Yeah.
But with what ease some of them put a puck in the net, because really, you're facing down a goaltender, and the closer you get, the smaller that net gets, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can see less and less and less of the net, and thinking about what you're going to do, not second-guessing yourself, like it's, breakaways are intense. And so for Matt Martin to pull that off, I was...
That's why so often I think you see guys just shoot it because they know they're going to overthink it. So just get the shot off because it'll be better than the failed, you know, toe drag backhand you're going to try.
Would you rather shoot or deke and fail spectacularly? Neither you score on. See, I'd rather deke and fail spectacularly because at least I tried. But if you shoot and you either miss the net, which happened so many times as a Leaf fan in the last few years, or you shoot and it like hits them in the pad. It's like, oh, that's so boring. At least you've entertained somebody.
I think if you miss a shot, that's the reaction.
Yeah.
If you completely whiff on the deke attempt, ah!
See, I like that reaction better, though. That's a bigger reaction.
No, come on.
Yeah.
You know what's great? These are all hypotheticals because he scored.
You know what someone needs to do?
What?
Top 10... Like, are you
whiffed breakaways?
Whiffed breakaways. The
Patrick
worst,
Steffen.
I don't know.
When he was with
Rangers,
the Dallas Stars.
Does that count though?
Well, it was an empty net.
Yeah.
And then they came back and scored.
Yeah, I remember that.
Oh my god.
Dennis Weidman had a really embarrassing one in the shootout where he like his leg stopped working.
Who's Patrick Steffen? Drafted by, was it Atlanta or New
Atlanta?
York? Oh, it was Atlanta. That's what I got him mixed up with someone else. I got him mixed up with Pavel Brendl.
1999. There was actually a really interesting article on Reddit yesterday. You know, Brian Burke, for all the flack we give him for his time in Toronto, and rightfully so, the way he got the Sedins to Vancouver was masterful. It would take too long to explain.
But there's a Reddit thread on it. You can check it out.
There's a Reddit thread. Basically, they had the third pick. They turned that into having the third and fourth pick, which they turned into having the second and third pick, which they turned into the Sedins.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Even that might not be right. Oh, God. There was so much. I think they even had to get the first pick at some point, and then they traded down to the second. It was nuts. It was absolutely nuts. But Burke was hell-bent on not leaving that draft without both Sedins.
Wow.
And he got it.
He did it. Made it happen.
Mm-hmm.
Now, We got a lot to cover today. There's a lot going on, and surprisingly, a lot of it has broken this morning, which has been great.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to start with the Leafs versus Edmonton. Now, by the time you listen to the show, game might be over, but all the same, I think it's so funny.
Might not be because it's a late game, right? Because
it's a late game.
West Coast.
That's right. And Jesse and I are on vacation.
Yeah. Oh, the both of you.
Both of us.
Yeah. Oh, I didn't know it was both of you.
When
I'm
vacation,
you're going to Vancouver, of course.
What do you want me to do when there's no show?
Yeah.
How do I work?
Yeah.
Fair enough.
We hold hands and we skip off onto the vacation thing together.
Oh, that's so nice.
So for the next 2 weeks, we're free and clear. Still doing this, though. Kadri versus McDavid is the story.
2.0.
Not Matthews versus McDavid. And I find that really funny. Like,
and I'm like, yeah, concentrate on that one.
Yeah.
Do it. Yeah.
For sure.
Yeah, that sounds good to me.
You know, Kadri did do really, really well against McDavid last game, although I have to say, he's still Connor McDavid. Like, let's not pretend he had a terrible game. He didn't.
And they outshot the Leafs by like 10, 15 shots. And the Leafs won. Hooray. But Edmonton still looked pretty good. They got close to 50 shots. I think more often than not, when you achieve that, you're going to win.
Absolutely. Now, now that the Leafs are playing in Edmonton, they don't have the matchup. Yeah. They can't match up the same way.
Yeah.
So how do you handle that? How do you think that's going to... Because there's no question Kadri is going to be on McDavid if they're on the ice together.
Sure.
But if you're Mike Babcock and you're away, and you have to do this in the playoffs too, and because I think it's because the Leafs haven't been in the playoffs, we haven't seen Leaf teams do this. How do you handle that?
I think you just have no choice but to be more conservative with the way you play. The defense can't help you out on the rush quite as much. I really don't know. I every time I watch the highlights, there is no containing Connor McDavid. There isn't.
No.
There is just... All you can do, I think, is try to guide him to the outside. Because you're simply not going to keep up with him. He's too fast.
So if you can guide him to the outside, you're just lowering his shooting percentage.
I guess, basically.
But even then.
Yeah, like they talked about... I still remember a couple years ago, OHL final, Erie Otters versus Oshawa Generals. They talked about how the Oshawa Generals, specifically Cole Castles, Canucks prospect, a center that the Generals had, they shut McDavid down. Really? Really? No. It was the Gens threw three guys on McDavid every shift and just tried to prevent him from passing.
Right.
That was all they could do. And he still got through a few times, still got some passes off, and just by the grace of God, the Generals still managed to win.
Well, it's funny because I initially thought of that, and I mean, again, this is, what is this, game 22? Like, it's not, it's important, but it's like...
It's pretty early.
It's game 22.
Yeah.
I love the fact, though, that we're out here building some drama for a game. This is what we should be doing.
The whole West Coast trip is high drama. You got the Oilers, Kadri, McDavid, number two, and there's some animosity there, and I bet you this is going to be a pretty chippy game. Calgary, not so much intrigue on the rivalry side, but everyone seems to think some kind of trade is imminent.
Which we'll get to.
Because, both sides keep checking each other out. And then, I mean, WrestleMania, December 3rd, which Jesse gets to go to.
Oh my God. If you're in Vancouver, December 3rd, right?
Yes.
December 3rd, if you're at the game, Jesse Blake will be there signing autographs. He'll have his own section.
Look for the tallest guy there, not named Nikita Trampkin.
Yes. Look for the guy yelling Toronto rules.
can you try to start a Toronto thunderclap in Vancouver?
Yes, 100%.
Thunderclap?
I am chanting Go Leafs Go all game long.
Oh,
yes.
Oh, I love it.
You know what's great is you're going to be really well received and everyone's going to love that.
Everyone will love me.
I'm sure it'll be great.
Yeah, the whole building's going to be Toronto fans anyways.
Ooh.
Wow. It is sort of like, I mean, it doesn't matter where you go. I don't know how Vancouver is, but I know Edmonton and Calgary. Every time Toronto swings through, there's a lot of Easterners out there.
Yeah, I kind of got ripped off my Toronto-Edmonton game that I went to in Edmonton because the Leafs scored in the first minute of the game and an already severely defeated fan base, and this is pre-McDavid, was just like, oh. Oh. And of course the Leafs end up...
We thought this would be the one.
We thought we had him this time.
Oh my God.
And then the Leafs end up winning 4-0. James Reimer with this shutout there.
Oh my God.
And... you know, they weren't as mouthy as I wanted them to be. You need the enemy territory feel.
You want some competition.
Yeah.
I like that Edmonton, I bet Edmonton fans are so tired of hearing how Nazem Kadri, quote unquote, shut down McDavid.
Oh, yeah.
And scored the overtime winning goal. Oh!
This is going to be years of frustration getting alleviated, I think. Is this the first... No, the Leafs have played McDavid once in Edmonton. I think that was last year when I did that psychotic LFR with the orange ball. Okay, so this is number two. But still, it's both teams are on their way up.
Yes.
And I think there's finally some passion, some drama in the Canadian matchups. I love it.
It's great because I mean, even at the end of last season, when was it? No Canadian team made the playoffs.
Yep.
It was like there was no drama in any city except for the failure drama, which we were all pretty tired of, I think.
Oh yeah.
And it's nice to see Ottawa in the race.
Yeah, I'm
they're well ahead of us. Boy. I'm perplexed by how they're doing it, but they're doing it.
How I saw they had the NHL.com writers vote on who they think is going to win the Jack Adams. How isn't Boucher, Guy Boucher, number one?
I don't know.
He's got to be.
Should be. Needs to be.
Yeah.
I mean, truly is. And again, he would have been the least coach had Babcock not come along.
He was very close. Supposedly he was like in Toronto or something like that. Yeah.
And then the private jet flew in with...
That's nuts.
With some opportunity on board.
Opportunity.
But, you know, like, this is a guy who really and truly was quite good in Tampa Bay. It was surprising that he wasn't hired before Ottawa got him.
Yeah, his long break in, like, Switzerland was weird.
Maybe he just liked Switzerland. Maybe he did.
Maybe he was waiting for the right job because he can.
Yeah, maybe because he can. And you know what? Living in Switzerland... Google pictures of Switzerland. I've never been there.
Well,
but I don't think I'd want to leave.
You know what I was thinking about Gerard Gallant, if we're getting into that, because...
We will in a sec.
Okay, sure. It's basically, everyone seems to think Jack Capuano is going to get fired.
Which we will also get
from the Islanders, yes.
This is perfect. This is teasing the entire show.
There you go. And I was like, oh, well, Gallant would be the perfect replacement. I'm like, well, wait. It's the same with free agents. Oh, why didn't the Leafs sign this guy? Well, maybe he didn't want to. So, like...
Yeah, remember when Brad Richards... Stamkos this summer. Richards five years ago. Offered more money. And he was like, no, rather go to New York.
Why didn't the Oilers sign David Clarkson? Well, because the Oilers offered more money. Well, he wanted to become a Leaf.
God, can you imagine?
Maybe not the best example, but... Oh, yeah, that'd be pretty awful.
The reason I wanted to bring up the Leafs, and Nazem Kadri specifically, obviously, going in tonight. Jesse, did you... You were looking. Oh, that's a goal. I thought you wanted to say something. No. Steve, you tweeted something bold on Saturday night, and Jesse and Steve and I had a guys' night on Saturday at Steve's house. Yeah. It was a blast.
It was rowdy,
and we actually had some great ideas.
Adam's not very good at chill.
No, he tends to put down his controller and write things on his phone you're trying to...
We had some amazing ideas, and I was like, I better write these down. I better write them down.
That's true.
The juices were flowing.
So it was Adam and I versus Jesse, and I actually scored a goal while Adam had his controller down. I'm like, keep it down. You suck.
You scored a couple, didn't you?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, I'm like, pretty good. They say
10-6 or something.
Oh yeah, Jesse freaking just turned the Jets on.
Jesse's been practicing. We'll put it that way.
Yeah.
What did you tweet about Nazem Kadri? And you were like, Adam, this is before Jesse even got there. Adam, I'm gonna go out. I'm gonna do it. I've been thinking this for a while, but I'm just gonna come out with it.
I'm throwing it out there. This is for the podcast world, the YouTube world, even the radio world.
Take this, radio.
Nazem Kadri should be in the conversation for this year's Selke Trophy, which goes to the best offensive forward.
Hold on. That is not what you said.
What?
That is not what you said.
What did I say?
Jesse,
Kadri for Selke.
Bingo.
Oh, that's it.
You didn't say in the conversation.
In the conversation. Don't backpedal.
In the conversation, and the conversation should go, Nazem Kadri should win the Selke Trophy.
There we go. All right. I want definitive opinions here, sir.
Well, okay. The Selke Trophy is the defensive center who's scores a lot trophy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The Yuri Lettinen.
This is known.
The Yuri Lettinen trophy.
Yeah, except Lettinen was like the last winger who was allowed to win it. So, like, it's defensive center.
Yeah.
Kopitar is always in the conversation. Bergeron is always in the conversation. Taves is always in the conversation. Taves has been battling injury. Mm-hmm. And whenever it comes to winning awards, every game missed is vital. Bergeron has still been spectacular defensively. Doesn't matter. He's not scoring as much. And that's how this thing works. So you got Kopitar. But you look at, like, Kadri has been taxed with shutting down every team's top offense. And he's scoring. If you look around the league, like, okay, they said Alain Vigneault should be the front runner for the Jack Adams right now. We're not saying he's going to win the Jack Adams. But based on the season so far, Kadri is... at worst, a nominee.
Mm-hmm.
Who's been better? Oh, wait. it's a bit of a joke of a trophy. Like, is McDavid that bad at defense that he shouldn't win it? No, but it's just...
Well, if we're being honest, wouldn't Crosby win it every single year? He's probably
yeah,
the best.
But that's
is he
not
the best
how it
defensive
works.
Center, though?
I would say.
He's a good defensive center in the fact that no team is allowed to play offense when he's on the ice because it's Sidney Crosby.
I think we're looking for more than just, you know, offensive prowess. Obviously, the Selke to me is your skill in the defensive zone, your ability to shut people down. Now, the McDavid shutdown thing is a bit overblown. However, we have seen, and Edmonton fans, forgive me on this one, we have seen real flashes of Nazem Kadri doing the same thing game in and game out, because he's assigned a role, which is shut down this guy, almost like Shane Corson used to when he was with the Leafs, when he had to shut down Alexei Yashin. However, Shane Corson was not as big of a role player as Kadri is.
And didn't score. I think, you know, we talked about when teams come to Toronto and how it means something. And like the Blues, for example, I'm trying to remember what it was.
China
it's
Club?
Be.
Is it China Club?
No.
Okay.
No.
Mets didn't let you in the Blues in?
No. So it's when the Blues come to town, or I think it's when the Leafs go to St. Louis, because they know they're going to have all those eyes, they're debuting, I think it's a new jersey, or they're making some
the
kind
Blues
of
are?
Making some kind of announcement. I can't remember. Jesse, maybe you can look it up.
So are you saying that playing in Toronto is...
It's a big deal. But that
it's
game...
It's also...
What?
Not like...
Oh, it's not like St. Louis. Thank you, Adam. It's always great when Adam tries to spoon feed me, and I'm like, I don't know. I don't get it. I can't do it.
I want to guarantee that everybody listening to that was like, not like St. Louis. Yeah. He's going to go to...
The YouTube version is great, because you see Adam like, yeah.
Sorry.
But that game was one of the biggest on the calendar so far in terms of hype. Mm-hmm. At least it was here in Leafland. Connor McDavid coming to town.
Absolutely.
And they spoiled his party. It was his party.
Right.
Wherever he goes, it's his party. And the Leafs spoiled it.
But who was better through 58 games?
That's oh, yeah. Like who was better through... Oh,
who
my God.
Who was better through 58 games in 15 minutes? That's what I want to know. Break that down for me.
And then he went on a crazy goalless drought, and he broke out of it.
Yeah, oh, my goodness.
Now he's making everyone pay.
Hey, by the way, you know, just before anybody freaks out on your Selke, Kadri Selke award thing, it is very funny and timely that we're talking about this, because Chris Johnson put up an article we can check out at sportsnet.ca. We love Chris. He's going to be on the show next Monday.
Yes, that's right. Yeah.
So we're going to kind of do a, you know, quarter season, little past quarter season wrap up of the Leafs and how they're doing. But what he does say, it backs up your point completely, and you can read it. It just kind of talks about the progression of Nazem Kadri as a defensive center.
Oh, that's right, yeah.
And how that is so important to the growth of the Leafs. Now, I say this now because I do want to transition into the trade rumors that have been circulating the team. So the trade rumor is this. Dougie Hamilton to the Toronto Maple Leafs, and everybody's speculating, and I mean everybody, I just mean Twitter. If you look at, just search Dougie Hamilton on Twitter. Just search those two words. You'll see...
The new Jacob Trouba.
Yeah. I do Kadri. No. Kadri. I honestly got to say, if you trade a Nazem Kadri...
Yes.
Yes, you have stabilized your defense, but you have destabilized your offense.
Well, I would say you've destabilized your defense. Because you've taken away, like, the one center you know for sure can play a full 200.
And what does he make?
I think it's 4.5.
For the next 5 years?
Six
years.
Well, this year and the next five, yeah.
And my point in saying that is that I wouldn't be so quick to give up Nazem Kadri. Now that he's now, in the last, I would say, season, and starting around this time last year, we started to see it come together. He's finally found a role. He's been with the organization like 8 years.
Yeah.
And he was supposed to be this big goal-scoring center. And I remember Ron Wilson wouldn't put him in, wouldn't bring him up because he wouldn't play defense.
You know what he was advertised as? He was advertised as Mitch Marner currently.
Yes.
That's exactly what he was advertised as. This
crafty was a word.
Crafty. Feisty. Craft. Little. I remember Kadri used to be our barometer for little. Guy from the London
Crazy.
Knights.
Yeah.
No, but now Mitch Marner is allowed to be Mitch Marner, and Kadri is, I don't know, this thing that I don't think a lot of people would have ever pegged him as in junior.
Mm-hmm.
A defensive center? What?
Yeah. What? And it's kind of neat to see because he's still got all the hands and all the dangles and the speed. And, mm-hmm. and you need that to be a defensive player.
Who were people raving was the best defensive center in the game for like 10 years? Pavel Datsyuk. That guy could do it all too. Mm-hmm. Now, Steve, are you really comparing Datsyuk to...
No.
Well, in a way, yeah.
Yeah, you're not saying that Kadri's better than Datsyuk before everybody takes that personally. Yeah. But it's a comparison that's worth
making.
Well,
it's like if I say someone should be up for the Hart Trophy, and are you comparing them to Gretzky? Well, no, okay, just because Gretzky won it a bunch of times. No, I'm just saying, against his peers in the NHL this year,
mm-hmm.
who's been better? You might come up with a name or two, but there aren't many. There aren't many. He's in the conversation, guys. He's there. And I'm just starting it because, I don't know, I think we can.
Now, I gotta say, are the NHL awards written, or are they done by, they're done by the writers, right?
The Pro Hockey Writers Association, not all of them. Some are voted on by the players, some are voted on by, like, management. I can't remember which ones are voted on by who. The Norris was the Pro Hockey Writers Association, and, you know, God bless Drew Doughty, there was certainly an argument that he should have won. Okay, I'm not up in arms that Drew Doughty won the Norris, but you gotta also admit it was obvious that people simply mid-season decided this is his year to win it.
Well, it was like Leonardo DiCaprio in The Revenant.
Yeah, he's winning this year.
Leonardo DiCaprio, for me,
this is his Revenant.
Yeah, it was that his best movie? Was that his best performance? Absolutely not. The Revenant was long and boring, straight up long, boring, not a great movie. Was he good in it? Yeah, he was really good, but Leonardo DiCaprio deserved that for many other things. It's like Drew Doughty and Leonardo DiCaprio were winning for bodies of work rather than that specific movie or that specific season.
Lifetime Achievement Award.
But yeah.
Presented as best actor.
Exactly.
In a lead role.
Exactly right. So the Leafs, apparently there's interest in Dougie Hamilton. Now, from what we've heard, there have been no phone calls, not one, back and forth. That doesn't mean there haven't been. It just means that's what we've heard.
Well, they've been visiting each other's games, and not just scouts, but like people in high roles. I think the Leafs director of pro scouting, shoot, I forget his name right now, was at one of the Flames games in Calgary, and they sent someone of high profile status to Toronto as well.
Okay, so let's say that there are discussions ongoing. And like I said, this is all hypothetical.
And it doesn't have to be Hamilton.
It doesn't have to be Hamilton. That was my thing. I looked at this, first off, to me, the most interesting aspect of this is not that it's Dougie Hamilton. It's that Calgary's wanting to make a trade for a big piece. That they'd be willing to listen to something like that. I think that they're a team that is very low-key, underperforming their own expectations, and there could be some changes there. There are. You got Giordano, TJ Brody, Dougie Hamilton, and who's the other big moneymaker on the Flames?
Oh, nuts.
I'm going to hate myself.
Well, it was Chris Russell. No, he's a forward.
Oh, it was Chris Russell. Oh. Yeah,
it was Chris Russell, but he's not.
Can we pull up
so
the Flames
money?
Roster?
I got it.
We got it? Okay, so who do we have on D?
On D is Giordano, Hamilton, Weidman, Brody.
Weidman.
Holy smokes, so they had a real expensive decor last year.
Yeah.
Yeah.
$25 million, something like that.
It was really expensive, which made them not making the playoffs hurt that much more.
Yeah. And I know
they
had
horrendous goaltending.
They're not giving up on TJ Brody. Or they're not trading TJ Brody, I don't think.
No, but you know what I see with Calgary? So what can you bring up Chad Johnson's numbers there? Jesse, and also Brian Elliott.
Okay.
Cause one thing that I said heading into the season, like Kiprios was adamant. That, yes, all the rookies are great and they're exciting with the Leafs, but Frederik Andersen is the key to their success.
Yeah.
And he has been. He started the season poorly. The Leafs were doing poorly. He recovered. The Leafs have recovered. It seems pretty obvious. Where Freddie Andersen goes, the Leafs go. With the Flames, I was like, well, okay, they had the worst goaltending in the league last year, and they replaced them both. They went out and they got Brian Elliott, and they got Chad Johnson. Now, what are their stats, Jesse?
Chad Johnson, 7-4-1, 9.22 save percentage.
That's not bad.
Pretty good.
Brian Elliott, 3-9-1, 8.85
save percentage. Now, this is where you got to give Babcock some praise. Okay, granted, Calgary seems to have gone with the hot hand, and Chad Johnson is doing well. How is Brian Elliott ever going to recover? Babcock left Freddie in net and said, you figure this out. You're our guy. Now, Calgary hasn't definitively said, you're our guy.
You'd think with a Brian Elliott name coming in, though, they'd have to do that.
That's what I assumed they were doing. But they've gone with Chad Johnson before. But if you're going to make the playoffs, I would think that Brian Elliott would have to come back up.
Yeah.
To an above 900 goalie. Like, what was that? 878?
885.
885? Gosh.
That's painful.
Yeah, last year.
And it's not like this is a small sample size.
Yeah. No, that's like Ramo last year.
You couldn't, if that's the as many games as many backups get in this league. You couldn't sell yourself as a backup with numbers like that.
No. You couldn't sell yourself as an NHL player with numbers like that. But Brian Elliott has a big enough body of work that we know he's not that bad.
No, mm-hmm. Of course not.
He's not that bad. So, like, whoever makes a trade with Calgary could be robbing them blind, because I don't think their problems are as serious as they seem. I really don't.
Well, so here's the rumors coming out of Calgary that Treliving is on the hot seat. GM is on the hot seat. Here's the deal, guys. They fired their head coach, who the season before, I believe, won the Jack Adams. By the way, that happens a lot.
Oh, yeah. It's the kiss of death. I hope Babcock never wins it.
Yeah, seriously.
It's the kiss of death.
I think it'd be too easy to give it to Babcock anyway. Like, he is one of the top three coaches every year. Him, Quinville. Yeah,
the Jack Adams is the biggest joke of a trophy.
Sutter.
In hockey. Yeah. Because it is the team that overachieved award.
Yeah.
I didn't expect this team to be as good as they are award. John Tortorella was one of the favorites. Now, what happened between last year and this year that made him, like, did someone just put all this coaching skill and knowledge into his head? Did he change his ideologies about hockey like that dramatically? Or did Bobrovsky just pick up his game? And Werenski got introduced to the lineup, and, you know, just a bunch of things are going right for the Blue Jackets. I'm not trying to diss Tortorella, but I'm just going, like, we said Guy Boucher. It's because we thought the Senators would suck, and they don't right now. That's what it is.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't know where we were going with that. I'm sorry. But
So we're talking about, you know, Calgary being on the, you know, a little bit on the hot seat. Mm-hmm. Just, you know, management, coaching, and... Honestly, like, when they fired Bob Hartley, it was kind of like, that was kind of a surprise. Because I feel like this, and I think we mentioned this before, when Calgary got into that second round, that was really damaging. Because they,
in a way,
they set themselves up with some serious expectations, which, by the way, they have expectations on this current team that go back two seasons. They're ignoring last year as if it didn't happen and going, no, that was abnormal. That was weird. We had bad goaltending or whatever. This year, this is our year. I don't think so. I don't think this team is maybe as good as they thought they were.
I think you might be a little bit off there, but with the same result is what I'm going to say. Because I heard them say when they made the playoffs, they got a little lucky. They said it over and over and over again. And they were the cardiac kids. They were this young team, always with the crazy third period comebacks. And they were ridiculous. Easily the most fun team to watch that year. The analytics crowd kept going, this isn't going to last. And I think the Flames agreed with them. But they're like, whatever, whee! Because we're in the playoffs. Then last year happened. And I think the Flames were like, all right, here it is. Here it is. This is what we expected to happen at some point. And our goaltending is garbage. This season, 2016-17, we're going to come up because we're a young, exciting team. We're better than we were last year. We're better than we were 2 years ago. And we have better goaltending. We're going to trend upwards. Now, that hasn't quite happened. And now I think they're panicking. That's when the panic happens.
I think you got to go before they make any firings or whatever. I think... You got to go the full year with the head coach. You can't do 25 games and go, sorry, you're out. Like, I mean, what?
The Lakers disagree.
Yeah.
Like, who was that guy they fired after like six games? They're like, you're
gone. Oh, who was that?
He didn't even stick around long enough for us to get to know his name. I think it was Mike Brown.
I'm pretty sure it was just Kobe didn't like him, so they got rid of him.
Yeah, goodbye. You're gone.
LeBron has done that to people, too. LeBron will be like, yeah. No.
Oh, who, coach? Coach LeBron?
Coach LeBron James. Yeah. Vince Carter tried to pull that in Toronto here, too. He was like,
Was that with Sam Mitchell?
No, it was pre-Sam Mitchell, but he said they should have traded Chris Bosh's pick for help instead of drafting Chris Bosh and that sort of thing. Like, just asinine.
Anyway.
This is why the inmates don't run the asylum, but I think the thing is here, Calgary...
Bernie Bickerstaff.
Well, there you go.
What?
That was the coach that was fired from LA?
Coached 5 games, and that was it.
Bernie Bickerstaff?
I think that's what we got there.
That is a made-up name. That is not a real person.
Before we go to break here, I just want to...
That is an NHL 17 user-generated draft name.
Before we go to break, I want to point out something really quickly, and then we got to go. Brian Burke.
Yes.
He has been a part of 4 major organizations in the last 12 years, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, played a major role in all 4. So we got Vancouver, Anaheim, Calgary, Dell. Toronto. Okay. Yes.
And Hartford prior to that.
In all of those situations, except for Anaheim, his goaltending has been subpar.
Mm-hmm.
In all of those, who was Anaheim's goalie when they won the cup?
It was Jaguar, yeah.
I wonder if Brian Burke, maybe, this just seems to be a pattern, I wonder if he maybe puts a little bit too much stock into getting great defense and not enough stock into getting great goaltending. Because even Roberto Luongo, I believe, was a Nonis move. Wasn't it?
That I'm trying to remember. Because with the Canucks, didn't it go Burke, Nonis, Gillis?
Yeah.
I'm trying to remember, but yeah, and he set the Canucks up for decades with the Sedins.
But they had to get Roberto Luongo before it started to happen for them. Look at the Leafs.
Yeah, they had Dan Cluche and
Bernier. Well, Bernier wasn't him. Nonis was a Bernier thing. We had Reimer.
And he kind of lucked into Reimer, too. A little bit. He didn't draft him.
And with the goaltending market as soft as it is this year, or especially going into last summer, I am surprised, honestly, and nothing against Brian Elliott, but I'm surprised Brian Elliott was all they went out and did. I would have been all over Fleury. I'd have been all over Anderson.
It's funny you say the goaltending market is soft, because I'll say something, and this will lead well into something I know we're going to talk about in the next segment. The goalie market sucks right now. You're not going to get anything for a goalie. I think we need to talk about how much the winger market sucks.
Okay.
Oh, it sucks.
What's that going to lead into?
Strom.
Oh, yeah, Ivan Strom. Okay. So we're going to talk about the winger market. Yeah, we'll talk about all of that next when we come back on Sportsnet 590, The Fan. And if you're unaware, Ryan Strom, one of the top draft picks a couple years ago, has been healthy scratch for the last 2 games. We'll tell you why.
What?
Jesse has something to add.
Adam was correct.
Huh.
Nonis acquired Luongo.
There you go.
So that's 3 teams in a row now where he hasn't had Brian Burke his... Well, not 3 teams in a row, I guess. He went to Anaheim first. 3 teams out of 4 where he has... And really, Jaguar was great in those years. But when you've got Pronger and Niedermeyer, he doesn't have to be great.
They didn't...
I think Brian Burke might not put enough into goaltending.
I'm not saying Brian Burke is this, but I know scouts who... They could tell you everything about a forward, everything about their game. Everything about a defenseman, everything about their game, all the little things, all the minutia. And then you ask them about goalies and they go, I don't know how to touch that stuff.
Wow.
I don't know. Because like, they kind of leave goaltending to the goaltending experts. But like, if you know a forward or a defenseman inside and out, surely you should know how to play with your own goalie. You know?
Yeah.
Know their tendencies. If you're a premier scorer in the NHL, you should know something about goalies. You know how to beat them.
Mm-hmm.
They're your main competitor.
But it seems like it's just a weird, mysterious...
Yeah, oh, goalies are voodoo. No, yeah. I don't know. I don't know how much goalies are voodoo.
I would love... One day I hope we get to interview Brian. That would be a dream interview. And that's one of the things I would ask him. I don't want to say that Brian Burke doesn't value goaltending the same way. I don't want you to give you that impression. And I'm sure I have. I feel like it's probably something that eats at him. Like it's
Brian,
like,
you've never had a goalie. What's up with that?
But yeah. What you've never had truly in all those teams, he's never had an A+ star goaltender.
And ironically,
And that must be frustrating.
I think he might have even been the guy who drafted Jaguar, because Jaguar was drafted by the Whalers.
Really?
I think he might have been.
So it,
it's weird that he followed him.
It would just be interesting to talk to him about that and how hard it is to find consistent goaltending.
Which is crazy because it's never been at more of a surplus, I think.
Well, speaking of which, we need to talk about a team that has too many goalies and way too many problems for the amount of talent that you assume they had. So the New York Islanders have scratched fifth overall pick from, I think, 2 years ago, Ryan Strome. And this guy was
longer than that, but yeah.
This guy was highly, highly, highly touted. I believe, was he Morgan Riley's draft year or the year before, year after?
2011.
2011. Wow.
2011. So yeah, the year before Morgan actually. It just feels like he hasn't been there that long because I think it took him a while to like become a regular mainstay.
In his rookie season with the Islanders, he had 50 points in 80 games, according to HockeyDB.
Whoa.
Which is pretty good. The next season, 71 games with the Islanders, 28 points.
Whoa.
And and that includes a stint with Bridgeport, where he had, I believe, 4 points in 8 games.
Okay.
So that's a pretty significant drop off. You lose 9 games, you go down to half your points. So there's obviously an issue there. Hmm. That's followed by going into the playoffs. Jack Capuano, coach of the New York Islanders, calling out Strome, Bailey, and I believe it was Nelson. Yeah, Nelson. About their play, and he said they need to pick up their blank and get to work. And it's not X's and O's. It's our favorite words. Compete level.
Yes.
Favorite words, compete level.
Okay.
And then...
Which is a mystifying thing.
I'm setting up the story to get to this. And then I'm going to let you take over.
Sure.
So today, we find out that he's a healthy scratch for the second straight game. And here's what he has to say about it. He says, I don't know. And they ask him, okay, so what do you think that you need to do what do you think you need to do to get back in the lineup, play regularly? What do you need to do differently? And he says this. He said, I've either got to play better or find a way to make them more happy, I guess. Now, that's one of two things. That's a player that hasn't been communicated with. They're not telling him what he needs to do. Or that's a player they've beaten over the head with the information and he's still not getting it.
Maybe he's just done. He's just done with them.
So what do you think?
I think that is an example of a young man sounding very frustrated. And it's also kind of a defeated attitude. You know, like I think there are a few Leafs who probably feel that way, but they don't express it outwardly because Lou Lamoriello will come and beat them with a crowbar in the ankles and be like, what did you say? What do you say next time they ask you? I love being a Leaf. That's right. Who's the face of the franchise? There is no face of the franchise. The logo is the face of the franchise. That's right. Anyway, sorry, I've been watching The Blueprint.
That's funny.
And it's also, I think that is these days, because when a player requests a trade, oh, such a big stink. And like, it's almost not even worth the player's time. Jonathan Drouin formally requests a trade. Turns into this big stink. He's portrayed as the bad guy. And what happens in the end? He stays with his team. Jacob Trouba formally and publicly requests a trade. It's a big stink. He's portrayed as the bad guy. What happens? He's playing with the Jets again. You know? So what I think is now happening, you're seeing with Ryan Strome, and I think you're also seeing with Jake Virtanen this past week, you're seeing these young guys just... All they got to do is sound exasperated and frustrated. And that, to me, is a new, more subtle way of going, I don't like it here. I'm done. I don't like it here. Something has to change in order for me to have success. Now, the problem with Strome and the problem with Virtanen is their performance, unfortunately, isn't in their favor.
If they were playing well.
Yeah.
But there's no reason to sound exasperated if you're playing well.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. 100%. Unless you're losing. Unless you're playing well and the team's losing.
But, yeah. But then you seem like a diva.
Yeah. Like, well, but if Sidney Crosby, for example, sounds exasperated or frustrated, oh, you can bet a change is coming. But Ryan Strome, Jake Virtanen, shut up. Pack your bags, go to Utica. No one cares. You know what I mean?
Well, I think in Jake Virtanen's case, for sure, he has a point. In Ryan Strome's case, he may. And there have been rumblings. We've talked about...
Canucks fans have been awfully frustrated with Vertanen.
Canucks fans are frustrated with a lot of things.
Yeah.
And, listen, that doesn't exclude Vertanen. It doesn't mean he's played well, but really.
I think they rushed him. They rushed him and McCann.
Yep, absolutely.
Made a mistake. Whatever.
Now, it doesn't mean he can't come in and still be great. It just means that they need a completely different organizational structure and probably a cleaning of house.
Yeah, something needs to change there.
So I asked former guest, Gus Katsaros, hockey scout, what he knew about the situation. I said, like, listen, dude, like, I read like 5 articles on it today and I was like, all right.
Yeah. Great follow on Twitter. Cats Hockey, Cats spelled with a K.
Yeah. It's funny. You read these articles and you go, okay, that doesn't give me the nuance though. What's really happening here? So he said, I don't have any personal experience with Ryan Strome, but he said, but he has always seemed to be a bit of a rogue in that since he was scoring and then in brackets being successful, coaches let his play sort of slide. But the NHL is where it's much tougher to adapt and score with his approach and it can get him in trouble. So he said, one thing to do is ask yourself, is he being truthful? He's like, I mean, has the coaching staff really not told him to play within their structure? On the other side, perhaps the coaches haven't done a good job communicating with him about his specific issues. And he said, you know, he's like, I wish there was a little bit more. He said, I wish it could be more exacting than that. But I think those are important things to talk about. And, you know, quite honestly, who would you rather get rid of than the Islanders? Is it Jack Capuano? Because the Islanders, the entire team has underperformed. Mm-hmm. Or is it Ryan Strome, who still has potential? I'm going to go with Capuano. And I also think the reason the Islanders aren't as good this year is because they're not as good this year. I don't think they're as talented. We thought a couple years ago they looked
like... Yeah, you look at them on paper.
They don't look like
much. That is not a threatening-looking team at all.
And then they go out and blow a bunch of money on Jason Chimera and Andrew Ladd.
Andrew Ladd. But I think they overestimated how good Ladd would be. I think he's also underperformed a bit. Like, there's...
But if
it's hard because it's early in the season.
Andrew Ladd is what Andrew Ladd is. He's a good leader. He's the player that he is. If he's come in and he's underperforming and the rest of the team is underperforming, does that not strike you as coach?
Yeah. Jesse, what's their goaltending like?
Oh, this is the fun part.
Because I know they got the three-way goaltending. It's the three-way goaltending thing.
Which they also hate.
Berube, Greiss,
Halak.
And Halak.
Yeah.
Have they been good?
I can bring up their numbers.
Sure. Because, I mean, great goaltending covers up a lot. Covers up an awful lot.
Yeah.
Been seeing it with Freddie.
But we thought, a couple years ago, we did this show. I remember talking about this specifically. And was like, don't sleep on the Islanders. Boy, they look good. They look good. If you take John Tavares off that roster.
Yeah.
That's a Vancouver Canuck team.
The Blackhawks... Without Taves, if you look at their lineup on paper, oh boy, that's a little bit rough, but they still have the star power to get through it.
Yeah, you've got Kane, you've got Crawford, you've got Seabrook.
Yeah,
of Duncan course. Keith.
The Islanders don't have that. They do not have that.
Halak is 3-6-4 with a .904 save percentage.
That's bad.
And Greiss is... 4-4 with a .920.
That's good.
Yeah.
Oh boy, they got to figure it out, man. They got to figure it out because Halak is not getting traded anywhere with numbers like that. Anywhere. Now, there's an interesting trade partner for the Flames. Brian Elliott for Yaro Halak or something. Yeah, it's simply not.
Hamonic for Dougie Hamilton, although Hamonic doesn't want to get traded anymore.
Why would you trade for a $4.5 million maybe goaltender?
Who's locked up through next year?
You don't.
No,
what's the most that you can hold, like, salary wise?
I think it's 50%. So he'd be 2.225.
If I'm really struggling at 2.25, and a guy might need to change the scenery and has a body of work, sure, take a chance at 2.25 until next season. Whatever.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a whatever.
If they're gonna pay it, then that's okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can the Islanders afford to do that?
Hey, that's I wonder too. And I haven't read this I have to read the CB. One day I'm going to read the CB. I'm going to try.
Yeah.
But I wonder, okay, so say Steve is making $5 million.
Okay.
And I trade Steve to Jesse's team, mm-hmm. okay? Okay, so I've traded Steve over to Jesse's team, okay. But I'm paying 2.25 of his salary, okay? Yes. What if Jesse wants to then trade him to the Vancouver Canucks, but then cut, but then retain half of the half? Can you do that?
Oh boy, you can.
Yeah, you would have to look at. Are you thinking of the Rob Scuderi example from last year, Jesse?
Yeah, that might be where I'm. Because I think I've heard this before.
That was crazy. They like retained, and then they retained on the retention, and they retained on someone else who was coming the other way, and it was very confusing.
It's definitely possible.
Very, very, very confusing.
Interesting.
I think Tom tried to explain it, and I was just like, yes.
Yeah.
I get it.
Because typical NHL, we don't know what the hell's going on.
I don't know. I totally. Anyway, numbers.
I just think the Strome thing is interesting because you've got Chimera, Ladd, Strome, all these guys, Bailey and Nelson last year, underperforming. And I don't think the Islanders are as deep as they used to be. Without Okpozo there.
I think they overestimated... they're young guys. I think they thought they would have some young guys helping them out on their NHL roster playing big roles this year. I thought they thought Beauvillier would play a big role, Barzal, maybe even Dal Colle, and maybe even Hosang. And right now, I think, like, are any of those guys on the NHL roster?
I think
maybe
so.
Beauvillier?
Man,
what, one of the young guys got sent down.
I don't think Dal Colle's still, like...
He's a fifth overall pick.
And he was drafted a while ago. 3-4 years, wasn't it?
2014?
Oh, okay.
I think I was at the draft. He was picked. And that was the Hosang draft as well. So, like, the cavalry's coming, but I don't think it's arrived as quickly as they thought.
And they've, again, never figured out their goaltending.
I think they thought they had it figured out. For sure. I mean, Halak has looked better than this. But, I mean, if he's checked out, well, what better way to get out of that situation than to play well?
Yeah. That's why you should never check out of any situation. Keep playing well.
Worst case scenario, Vegas will grab you or something.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Islanders can keep Grice. It's a rough situation there on Long Island. But what sucks for Strome and what sucks for Vertanen, or at least one of the things, is we already saw how hard it was for Jacob Trouba. Who is a right-handed defenseman, which is a thing that is valued at a premium in the NHL. You're a scoring winger. Everyone's got those now. Everyone's got those. It's like, oh, everyone's got, like, you know, goaltending. Everyone, almost everyone has at least a competent goalie on their roster, barring injury.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why the goalie market's so bad. Everyone's got scoring wingers. Almost everybody has scoring wingers. Who's paid a ton in the NHL? Defenseman, and I think that's...
Top-line D.
Yeah, top-line defenseman.
Like
but I think
Doughties, your Yossis, those guys.
I think that's slowly going away a little bit, or it's coming down a little bit.
If you've got one stud, you'll put a lot of money in, but you're not going to do what Calgary did, which is $4.5-5 million into five different guys.
Exactly. And I think the number one commodity in the NHL, it's something that no one seems to be able to find. Unless it's through the draft, centers. That's why they get paid so much damn money. So if you can play C, good for you. And if you want to demand a trade, go ahead. If you're a winger...
Sorry about your luck.
You're the most plentiful commodity every team has.
Now, if you're...
Everyone's got eight wingers on their roster and probably have at least one in the press box, too.
If you're a team, though, and you see a quote like this with Ryan Strome, are you not circling the waters going, oh.
Well, that's like I said about the Flames pulling off desperation moves, maybe being a little desperate. Who's more desperate than the Islanders right now? I tweeted they could be this year's Gong Show team, and I had people going, oh, the Canucks. Nah, some of that's carryover from last year.
Mm-hmm.
If we're just focusing on the season that each team is having, the Islanders should probably be the most embarrassed.
Let us not discount the Florida Panthers yet.
Oh my God.
It's still early.
Do we have time, or is that the online portion?
We're probably going to have to hit that in the online portion, but...
Okay.
Yeah. We've basically run out of time on the air. It's a good thing
and
you didn't
And the World
check.
Juniors, too.
And the World Juniors. We got a lot of stuff.
It's that
quickly,
wonderful time of the season.
Quickly.
There's too much.
We didn't get to this in the last thing. If the Leafs were to go after Dougie Hamilton, what's fair value?
Leafs fans, I'm not telling you it's going to happen. I'm just telling you to try to imagine what life without William Nylander might look like. That's all I'm going to say. because it might happen.
Why do you trade a 20-year-old center?
I will answer that question in the online portion. This podcast is brought to you by Panago Pizza. It's what's on the inside that counts. Download it at sportsnet.ca, iTunes, Pod Stitcher, SoundCloud, any place podcasts are found, including YouTube, where you can see our faces and our guts. Mostly mine. Mostly my gut.
Also this one.
Why do you trade? Why do you trade? Now, there have been a few rumblings about this, and I expect this story to take off a little bit with William Nylander. There have been people that have said that he doesn't try hard. There have been people that
try
say...
Try hard enough.
There have been people
that's
that
say... That's not just on the ice either.
It's off the ice.
Yes.
There have been people that have said he is frustrating to deal with. You never know. I mean, listen,
this was known, by the way. Like, this was... Like, the main criticism of him heading into his draft.
Is Dougie Hamilton good enough return for William Nylander?
Flames fans were tweeting about this. And naturally, a fan base is going to overestimate the value of their guy. We're going to get way too, or we're going to get JVR and a first and a
second. No, you're not. Second. No, you're not.
No, Flames fans were pretty reserved going, you know what? Last year, we might have been able to ask for that. This year, mm-mm.
No.
Mm-mm. What does Dougie Hamilton make there, Jesse?
5.5. And for the next 4 years.
That would make him...
Pretty sure it's 5.5.
That would make him the least highest paid defenseman.
Yeah.
That would make him
and then
the least highest paid player.
5.75.
Okay. It's a lot of money.
2021.
Ooh, baby.
I'm not trading William Nylander for that.
Yeah, I tell you. And what does he have this season? Like, what are his numbers?
For a supposedly offensive defenseman.
There's no way in hell I'm giving you William Nylander for that.
No.
He's got 2 goals, 10 assists in 25 games.
That's all right for a defenseman. I mean,
he would do well. Listen, he would do well with the Leafs, with the amount of goal scoring they have. I just think the William Nylander question to me is very interesting because we had the same shit with Nazem Kadri. It was the
and
same
we held
shit,
on to him.
And we held on to him.
He's 20 years old.
He's 20 years old. He's going to mature.
How are you giving up his first full season?
I was in year two of my career at 20. I had already moved away and then come back. I'd lived on my own for a year and then came back to Toronto. I was still an idiot. I was good at what I did, but I was still a fucking idiot. You're 20.
Oh, we're in the online portion now.
Yeah, you're 20. You're dumb. You're good at certain things, but you're dumb at others. That's okay. Like, and I understand that he's going to give you headaches, but
I think he's worth the headaches.
As you said when the Habs traded Subban.
Yes. I think he's worth the headache.
I think he's worth the headache. I'll take the headaches. The guy got 16 points. Like, what?
Who tweeted it? Oh, shit. Oh, well, anyway, it was a great point. Nazem Kadri is the Alex Steen that the Leafs kept.
Yes.
Don't let Nylander go. Unless you are just fleecing the other team, which I don't even know what that would be.
If you got Dougie in a first, because I don't think Flames are going to be that good.
Yeah, I think, what?
If you got McDavid.
Yeah, McDavid.
Then you swap him.
I don't even think that'd be worth it because, again, you've got to have guys who are in this pocket that they've created.
Man, that's a lot of money.
It's a lot of money. And then you've got
a lot of... A lot of years. Like, if he doesn't work out, you're fucked.
Yeah, and think about...
And there's no guarantee. Like, he looks good most of the time.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the time is a really kind way of saying some of the time. I'm paying you that money. You're looking great all the fucking time. All the fucking time. I don't care what stupid team you're on.
Mm-hmm.
I don't care how frustrating the Flames are.
What about... one of the things we brought up last episode was, who's that boring defenseman? A few people said Mark Pisick.
Mark Pisick was one.
Mark Edward
Vlasic,
which I was like, you guys are crazy. Yeah. He's an Olympian.
That's a little different, guys. We're talking about a spare part here.
I guess he'll be a free agent soon enough.
No, I don't know.
But another guy that came to mind was Travis Hamonic.
There's a guy. And again, Islanders, how desperate are you? What do you need? What do you got? I got it. Or what do you need? I got it.
What do they need? They need depth wingers.
Do they, though?
Look, bring up the roster. I like their first two centers. I like Tavares and I like Bailey.
Yeah.
But you lose Kyle Okposo and you didn't replace him. You have Andrew Ladd and Jason Chimera. Those guys are worth 40 points each.
That was a pretty big shift in the Eastern Conference that kind of went overlooked a little bit. I think because he got quite a big payday, but yeah, Buffalo, I think, really likes that they have Okpozo, and the Islanders are missing him.
Do you want to go through their forwards?
Let's go through their forwards.
All right, they got Tavares, Ladd, Grabowski, Kuhlman.
Who Lee. Grabowski? I don't even think is playing much.
No, he's on IR.
And Kuhlman's fourth line.
Mm-hmm. Josh Bailey, Kyle Clutterbuck, Brock Nelson, Ryan Strome, Chimera, Shane Prince.
That's not their core. There. I don't think that's that bad, man.
I don't think it's that good.
It's not. It's marginal. Yeah.
It's very marginal. Would you not want? And this is, again, this is all hypothetical, and Islanders fans will probably tweet the hell out of us on this one, and I don't blame you, but I feel like the Islanders need a skill guy to play with Josh Bailey. I think the Islanders need a skill guy to play with John Tavares. Well, you don't have your Okpozo.
They've had Jason Chimera on the top line wing this year.
That's bad.
You shouldn't have
Jason Chimera. You should not have a team that has Jason Chimera on. Does a team with Jason Chimera on the top line win a Stanley Cup?
I think the Islanders disagree that they need depth wingers because they got Ryan Strome as a healthy scratch, and they let P.A. Parenteau, who they had just signed, go to waivers. What is that team doing? What are they doing?
Parenteau's good for 20 goals, and he's doing great in New Jersey.
Depending on who you're playing with. Yeah, other than those two penalties you took against the Leafs. I'm sure that drove him nuts. Plays with fire. I would love to see what he does in the playoffs.
I'll take P.A. Parenteau. P.A. Parenteau playing with Tavares over Chimera playing with Tavares. Wouldn't you?
And 100%.
And Ryan Strome. Here's a guy. You talk about, earlier in the show, Anderson being like, okay, that's our guy. Babcock said that's our guy, and you're going to work through your issues. What about with Strome? And maybe they've tried this. Capuano's been the coach there for like 5 years. But what if you put Strome with Tavares and you go, you're staying there until you figure it out. And by the way, I'm going to be on your shit.
Well, maybe Islanders fans can help us out because maybe they've tried it.
They might have.
I don't know.
Well, and Gus said, he's like, the problem with Strome's play is that he hasn't been consistent enough to keep him on the top line.
Seems like every time they give Tavares a winger, they take him away. Matt Molson, I think Thomas Vanek.
It's almost like John Tavares is the Sundin Leafs in 2007.
Oh, see, that's why he's destined to be a Leaf. Because
does this make it more likely that he walks in free agency?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, maybe.
Doesn't mean
he's going to become a Leaf. But
no. Team's total shit.
Kind of does.
Yeah. Year and a half from now, team
kind of
is.
Kind of does mean that.
Don't. Oh, they're thinking about it. Okay. Because there's all this shit with their arena. And all the shit with their practice facility, and just the abject ridiculousness of the New York Islanders right now in terms of how they've handled these situations and the stupid spots they've got themselves into. Tell me they're not thinking, geez, we better get this turned around, otherwise Tavares is going to walk. Because if I'm Tavares and there is no future, why would you stay?
You're making me think stupid things. I can't do it. I was going through my head like, what could the Leafs trade?
Here's what I'm thinking. Okay?
No.
Here's how I'm thinking.
No.
I think Austin Matthews, center one, Tavares, center two, Kadri, center three.
We know that it's Tavares, center one.
Yeah.
We don't know that in 2 years.
Oh, I'm talking like
free
this
agent.
Year. Because
oh,
I'm
you're
stupid.
Not trading for Tavares.
I know. See, you're making me think stupid things. Stop it.
A nice fresh William Nylander. I would take Tavares.
Like we're talking about how like irreplaceable William Nylander is. Fuck, I'll drive him there. fuck driving him to the airport.
How fantastic
Brooklyn.
Your hair is, sir.
Oh my God.
I want Steve's lookalike on the Leafs.
Oh,
and
man.
I want him wearing number 10, even though that's not possible.
Man, you brought tunes, Willie? Here's the aux cord. We're going on a road trip. Oh, fuck.
I don't think Willie could take offense to that. I'm a William Nylander fan. I don't get that. But anyway, I wanted to...
He'll be fine.
I feel like the Islanders really... I'm sure if I'm Garth Snow, and I'm a realist, and I know it's already hard enough to get people to play here sometimes without overpaying for them, Andrew Ladd, Jason Chimera. I wonder how we turn this around. And I also wonder what the hell they were thinking signing those two guys. What was Ladd and Chimera?
Oh, yeah.
Why?
Yeah.
I mean, this is a team that literally was all skill, and now they are all not skill.
I get Ladd. I get it.
I don't get Ladd
it's
for that
too much money.
Dude. How much money?
Ooh, yeah, for 5.5 till 2023.
No.
Ooh.
No, you don't.
Wait, how many years is that?
It was an 8-year deal.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
Oh,
seven.
Fuck.
Oh, 7-year deal.
Okay, well, I get the logic. The logic is we're going to have a young team.
Mm-hmm.
He's been a captain. Take some pressure off Johnny. He's not a bum. We know he can score, but he's had a rough time doing that recently.
30?
Oh. That was, I'm sorry. That's just not a smart move.
Yo, Isles, and they, by the way, do not protect that shit.
7 years?
Do not, or unless they have
he
to.
He has a no movement clause.
Oh. How fast
did he sign that contract when it was offered to him?
Oh my God.
Oh my God.
He's like, I've won my cup. I'm good. I'm taking the money. Good for you. Good for Andrew and good for his agent. But I can't
remember who it was. It might have been Merrick on this podcast. Someone offers you that kind of contract and there's no pen around, you cut yourself and sign it in blood. Like, are you kidding me? Like, holy shit.
That's generational money.
Yeah. Is anyone around here diabetic? Give me a okay, thank you. Just right on the finger.
Your grandkids will benefit from that.
Like, oh my God, yeah. That's generational wealth. Just brutal. Before we get to Gerard Gallant,
which we will,
and the Florida Panthers and all that craziness, I do want to bring up something that I keep meaning to bring up, but I couldn't find the damn thing, and I didn't know how to find the damn thing.
Okay.
Allie Quinn on Twitter, Le Exiled One, DM'd me.
Hi, Allie.
Hi.
She's
so, the Leafs, have a really shitty schedule, and you will hear this often, and you'll be like, well, what does that even mean? So someone made a chart.
Are you telling me the Laughs?
The Laughs
have a laughable schedule?
Another, oh baby, another typical Toronto Laughs fan.
Laughs.
Another typical excuse. So there's a chart. There's a chart right here, okay? And it's in the pink, it's playing, it's your team
mm-hmm.
playing a rested team while tired, which means playing a team that I guess had a day off mm-hmm. and you did not. Versus in blue or purple, playing a tired team while rested. So playing a team that played the night before while you did not. We saw this against the Caps. The Leafs skated circles around the Caps, I thought. Does that mean the Leafs are way better than the Caps? No. The Caps were tired. The Leafs were not. The Leafs got schooled by the Islanders. Islanders are in a rough way. Does that mean the Leafs suck compared to the Islanders? The Leafs were tired. The Islanders, I'm pretty sure, were not. So, the Leafs, 14 times this season, out of 82 games, 14 times they play a rested team while tired. And only 8 times they play a tired team while rested. So they're -6 in that category. They have a harder schedule than most teams. I'm trying to find a team that has it worse. Only 2 teams have it worse, actually. Vancouver... Ironically,
because that just seems to be the rule for their poor fans.
Oh, it's just brutal.
I feel so bad for them.
They play a rested team while tired 13 times. They play a tired team while rested 6 times. Exact same for Buffalo.
Don't feel so bad.
But Leafs and San Jose are tied with that 14-8 thing.
But how easy has the Leafs schedule been up to this point?
They've already played, I think,
this a couple of those back-to-backs.
This upcoming back-to-back. The Calgary one will be their 5th time playing the second half of a back-to-back this season already.
Okay.
You know what
it's not even December. Like...
Yeah, but what is that in comparison to the other teams?
Oh, I don't know.
What if the average is 6?
I don't know.
So I don't know.
Well, but we know by the end of the season...
Yeah.
It will be that. Now, you know who's had a great start to the season?
Who?
And has the sweetest deal in the league? The Oilers play as a tired team against a rested team 8 times. They play as the rested team against a tired team 19 times.
Wow.
Nice.
And you have Connor McDavid. And
you have Connor McDavid.
And a Bobby Nix burger. I mean, come on.
Yeah. Anaheim also 19 times, but they are the tired team 11 times as opposed to the Oilers 8. So I'll retweet that at some point, or at least please remind me to. That is incredible to me. How shafted the Leafs are. And I mean, the Oilers one is more fantastic.
Mm-hmm. I think they should man the fuck up.
Wow. Okay.
Well, I don't think the Leafs are complaining about this.
Well, yeah, Babcock has said it like, it is what it is, right? Like, what do you do?
What do you do? Yeah, you
They're
deal
not
going
to change the schedule.
And by the way, do you think the playoffs are any better?
The only benefit to the playoffs is you and your opponent are on level playing field.
Mm-hmm. After That's, 82 games and everybody's beaten up.
Yes. Yeah.
So, sorry, I don't have an ounce of sympathy for them.
It does kind
of and I love the Leafs, but I don't have an ounce of sympathy. They have to not only are they one of the youngest teams in the league, which means they should be able to handle that better than most teams.
We can go through most teams in the league. Okay, Blackhawks, they've been without Taves.
Mm-hmm.
Panthers, they've been without Huberdeau.
Mm-hmm.
Who just got hurt on Carolina? Jordan Staal on Carolina.
Might stall their season.
LA is missing their goalie.
LA's missing every goalie in the world.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The Flames are missing Johnny Gaudreau. Mm-hmm. The Leafs?
No injuries.
Hunwick for about a week and Nylander for one game.
Mm-hmm. And by the way, we're pretty cool with Hunwick. We wanted him to take his time.
You know what's funny? If you watch the blueprint, if you watch all those episodes on the Leafs YouTube channel, they do a great job. I highly recommend watching them if you're a Leafs fan. They do a really good job of showing the veterans off the ice. Because if all you do is watch them on the ice, you go, these guys are... What the hell is Hunwick doing? What is Polak doing? What's their purpose on this team? Or even Matt Martin. Matt Martin was a guy they painted with a really rosy brush. But you do kind of see, like, okay, they do serve another
they
purpose.
They absolutely do. And by the way, the Hunwick thing was a joke. Sometimes our jokes are misconstrued as being serious.
I know.
How can you be happy that someone's injured?
What's the matter
with you? And you're like,
you?
Okay, all right. That was a joke. You know, I think... with the scheduling thing, yes, they have a harder schedule. Handle it.
It is what it
freaking
is.
Freaking handle it, man.
Every year. You're going to play 9 exhibition games or some stupid shit like that.
Which needs to stop.
Oh, my God.
5, max.
Yeah, but money is great, so there's that.
Yeah, especially in Toronto.
Yeah.
Where they sell out an exhibition game.
You know what's coming every year. You make all your cuts late.
Mm-hmm.
Let the young guys play it out. Keep the vets fresh. And deal with it.
Gerard Gallant.
Yeah, how about that, eh?
How did we
not talk about that on the radio?
I know. Well, you know,
that's all my fault.
I have to be. No, it's not your fault. It's mine. But the reason we didn't
bring
it up on the radio.
Fuck you. No, I'm sorry.
The reason I didn't bring it up on the radio is because it's been severely beaten to death on the radio.
Way too much.
And I wanted it to breathe a little bit. Now, Steve, you sent us a video. You think of all the videos you've done this year, your Gerard Gallant one is one of your best.
It was... one of the ones I'm most happy with.
Fair enough. Okay.
For sure. Of all my Sportsnet ones, I think I'm happiest with this one. I'm not really sure why. I think I had some points to make. I don't think they were half-baked points. And I think it was fair. I take pride in videos where I'm able to be fair. Totally objective.
Mm.
When it's the Leafs, it's hard to do. When it's the Leafs, it's hard to do. Panthers, like, I don't have a dog in that fight. I don't care. If the Panthers succeed...
you don't care if they Huber do or Huber don't.
If the Panthers succeed, it's a Leafs divisional rival doing well.
Yeah. Although we did...
What do I care?
It does make us look smart because we did say they'd be near the top.
Yeah. Now, this Gerard Gallant thing, though... Like,
well, first off,
yes,
poor guy had to pay for his own cab to the airport.
Yeah, and the Panthers forced him. Did you hear that?
Oh my God,
the Panthers.
This is a coach that makes like $1 million a year. I'm sure he can afford it. Although Tim Rowe didn't.
Yeah,
have
they
to
don't
go on...
tear his contract up.
Tim Rowe went on the radio the next day and said, "Don't worry, we'll pay him back for that."
No, I think that was.
I think it was
Tom Rowe
or Tom Rowe. Sorry,
or
Tim Rowe,
Doug Sifu, the owner.
Okay,
I hope that's how you pronounce it. Seafood. anyway, no, so what happened was, and people were ripping on me because I didn't mention this in the video. It wasn't that I hadn't heard that interview yet, but yeah, they called for a car and a cab showed up first. And I guess Gerard Gallant was like, I want to get the fuck out of here, you jerks. And so he just hopped in a cab and took off. Now, Panthers are one game above 500. They had a fantastic season last year.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of their shortcomings, you could definitely lump on Barkov's been in a slump. We've been missing Bjugstad most of the season. We've been missing Huberto all of the season.
Those are some pretty big names.
Those are huge. And they're above 500? They're two games out of the playoff picture? Mm-hmm. Fuck, Panthers are good. We're in a great spot.
Numbers-wise, this doesn't make sense. I mean, like, Andrew Berkshire, our favorite guy,
yeah,
Sportsnet.ca, put up an article saying, are they objectively worse? Actually, no. I mean, in fact, their offensive, I believe it's their course, he's better.
Oh, really?
But it's not... But I guess maybe... This obviously speaks to a mentality change.
Yeah, so Gallant was clearly not with it. He wasn't with the direction of the team. Rumor is he really hated Eric and Branson going. He wants the team to be bigger and play a little tougher. The Panthers are going for a more streamlined, faster team. Keith Yandle, Jason Demers, and all the young guys. It's just the optics of it, the timing of it, it's all bad. They're above 500. First game of a 6-game road trip, I didn't even realize. They fire him. So
that's weird.
Tom doesn't even get to play his first home game with the Panthers for another 6 games.
Does that strike you as like there was an argument?
There must have been a blow up.
I think
there must have been. They kind of, I was reading something. They went through it kind of game by game. Okay, they got spanked by the Leafs. Reimer had a bad game. I didn't think the Panthers were that bad.
No, it was clearly all on James Reimer.
Shut up! Grant Fuhr. They had another game I can't remember where they didn't look so good. And yeah, they coughed up a lead. They coughed up a 2-goal lead against Carolina, which, by the way, we just figured out that Florida has a much higher standard for chokes than the Leafs do. The Leafs have already done that at least 3 times.
Well, they should, though. I mean, they are supposed to be good. Well, the Leafs are not.
Fair enough. So I'm, you know, everyone seems to think that, like, literally a calculator wearing a tie walked in and was like, beep, boop, 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 beep. And Gerard Gallant was like, what do you mean I've been fired? Because Gerard Gallant can speak calculator.
I assume there's a method.
Is that spelled it out with the numbers? Yeah. You know how you, like, do boobs?
Boobless.
That's how it went down.
By the way, racially stereotyping calculators there.
What?
With your, like, beep, boop, 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 boop. You complain about Italians being like, hey! Oh, yeah. And you go do that to a calculator.
Italians speak fluent calculator.
they don't owe it to us to make it look good, right?
No.
They can fire if they didn't get along, they can fire him however they want, right?
I suppose. And do the Panthers really need to worry about how they look? They have no fans showing up to the games as it is.
Ooh. I'm not
doing that as a jab. Like,
sounds like a jab.
Biggest challenge? It's gonna be the players. The players.
And that's the
thing.
How
do you explain that to the players?
Yeah, supposedly a lot of them are crushed now.
And they love Gerard.
I don't know what message that sends. I'm gonna inject this because some people were talking about how's Jaromir Jagr gonna receive this news. Am I wrong in saying it doesn't matter that much? How old is Jagr? What, 44?
He's seen this before.
Well, he's seen this before. Maybe not quite this specifically, but he's seen this before. B, it's a young team. It's Aaron Ekblad's team. It's Barkov's team. It's Huberto's team. It's Bjugstad's team.
Jagr's a part. He's not the star anymore.
44.
I'd argue a spare part, man. Like, yeah, he offers some leadership.
Some points getting. He does well in
the points. He's a contributor for sure. But, like, in terms of making moves around pleasing him...
No.
What for? No.
Yeah, you might have him for 60 more games.
Yeah, and it's sacrilege to say that because it's Jagr, but...
Well, no, it's not. That's mentally how you need to process it. I just think... Yeah.
You have a vet like Jagr to get over that shit. I would hope that Jagr would be the type of player to help the younger guys get over that shit. And if he's not, trade him for a second.
I think
because you know he can get one.
I think the old school guys are looking at this, the old school media types especially, and the old school hockey guys are looking at this going, oh, the advanced stats guys are jacked about this. They finally have their team. Because the Panthers really
do.
What
the fuck does that mean?
Hang on.
Yeah, sorry.
I know you're right. You're totally right. I'm going down that same road. But the Panthers... do want to innovate. They want to try things that have never been tried before because really, they've got finally a good ownership situation. What do they have to lose, fans? Mm-hmm. I mean, truly, their games are not selling out. They have a good team. Why wouldn't you try some of these things out? Or they have a good team on paper. they're not performing the way they think they should.
Still, they're fine. Yeah, but they're in there. Yeah. They have two more points. We're not having this conversation. Oh, they're in a wild card spot.
Yeah.
They're great.
Huberto and Barkov and Bjugstad, those are big deal players for that team. Those are centerpiece players. So I think the thing is that when this firing happened, we saw a lot of takes, as you said in the video, Steve.
T-A-E-K-S.
Yeah. Takes.
Sean Mendes.
I think that in this particular situation, even the advanced stats community is like,
Well, and so what I was saying in the video is this is a battle of sunrise. It's happening. The analytics battle kind of went into a Cold War state. Where, just little jabs.
When you fight and fight and fight and you just leave each other alone for a little bit, but you hate them.
Yeah.
You eye them from the other side of the room. Yeah.
Now it's, it was amazing to me how many old school hockey media guys were not so thinly veiled, actively cheering for the failure of the Florida Panthers. Not just saying they disagreed with the move. There were a few guys, if an analyst says that, who cares? That's fine. That's their job. But I was seeing a couple journalists going, I don't give a fuck what your opinion is. That's not your job to say that. How dare you, almost. If I'm the Panthers, that's definitely what I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
These guys got to talk to their PR all the time. There's a few guys who aren't going to get fuck all for interviews. Because who the fuck are you? Why? How dare you say that?
Right.
But it's amazing how many people were very thinly veiled just cheering for the Panthers' failure going forward.
Well, and it's funny because
Gerard Gallant's your friend. Just say it.
Yeah. And if you are an old school guy,
we chill in PEI together. Just say it.
Well, if you are an old school guy,
I've gone drinking with Gerard Gallant. Just tweet it.
If you're an old school guy and you're saying that, oh, the advanced stats guys have moved in and they've taken over and that sort of thing. I got to tell you, it's not like Gerard Gallant has had flying colors with this year's team. And I'm not saying you can't take anything away from last year and you can't really take much away from this year, but it's not like the team's performed well. And I think if you want to say that the advance, all the fancy stats people, if you're actively rooting for the Florida Panthers to lose, well, they have been losing. And that's what they're saying is that it's not acceptable.
There was a really good tweet.
And they're not playing the style that obviously that management wants. Now, there was a run-in that we should bring up.
Oh, baby. Yeah, while I look for this, please bring that up.
Jesse, have you seen these tweets?
Oh, here's the tweet. Sorry. Before you bring up that one, this one's from Offersheet, and I've been waiting for the online portion I can actually say it. He tweets, and it's only got 2 likes because I can't retweet this. Oh, there. I just gave him a like. If you actually think a few advanced stats guys in Florida tasked with player research are responsible for Gallant's firing, you're a fucking idiot. It's true.
Yeah.
It is kind of true.
Well,
really.
Remember the movie Moneyball? The manager will not play the way Billy Beane wants him to, won't play the players that Billy Beane wants him to play. So he trades like the rookie of the year. Mm-hmm. He trades him away, I believe, for Ricardo Rincon. I wonder if that's the particular, this sort of same situation where Gerard Gallant's like, no, I'm playing them this way. And they're going, well, no, but if you play them this way, you're maximizing on their potential.
Interrupting the podcast, Paul Hendrick tweets and shout out to Hardev Lad for, tweeting, hurry and read this before the podcast is over. Paul Hendrick tweets, not seeing Peter Holland on the ice, Babcock to address that after morning skate. Methinks Petey might have been traded. Let's find out before the show's over. Yes, Gallant.
I feel like I looked at that and it was a weird firing. There was obviously something going on there, but I don't think the guys who are running the numbers are able to go in and go, you're gone.
Yeah, I
just don't think so. And now we got to talk about the run-in because.
Oh yeah, sorry.
So
this is
one of the guys at Sportsnet. Doug McLean, who I believe was a Florida Panthers general manager.
I don't know about GM. He was definitely coach. Yeah, he was the coach when they made it to the final.
Yeah. And he
Rats and Scott Mellenby and all that shit.
He tweeted the owner and said, congrats, you're a hockey expert now.
Now, in Doug's defense, we always rant and rave about ownership
getting in the way.
Fiddling.
However, do we ever tweet the owners directly? We say it on our show, which is our platform. Yeah. Do we ever personally attack? Now, is that a personal attack?
Oh, fuck yeah.
100%. Do you think that was a, do you think he was being like that? Or do you, like, do you think that?
Best case, he is on friendly terms with that person and he was ribbing him.
Okay. Fair enough.
Worst case, Doug's friends with Summers in the Maritimes, where I think Gerard Gallant does too.
Well, they go way back, don't they? Gallant and McLean.
I assume so. Was I don't know to what not, capacity.
Was he not the coach 1 year when in Columbus? Did they not work?
I don't remember. No. I don't remember. I know Gallant was the, I believe he was the head coach of the St. John Sea Dogs when they won the 2011 Memorial Cup in Mississauga.
Can we talk about, though, while we're on this,
yes,
what was the Florida Panthers owner's response?
I don't have it in front of me, but it was basically, oh, well, I really enjoyed every move that you made in your 9 years with the Columbus management. Basically saying, Aider Doug, go fuck yourself.
Yeah.
It's a really polite way of saying that.
But then Doug tweeted, hey, thanks so much.
I think that was Doug punching out of the argument. Some people were smart, like, wow, McLean's such an idiot that he didn't even understand. Come on.
When Doug McLean was GM in Columbus, Gallant was his head coach.
Oh, all right.
Nice, Jesse.
It's hard to remember
way
every
to know
head
stuff.
Coach
yeah,
ever.
It really is because they changed so much. But yeah, I mean, it's, oh, yeah, he well, said, thanks,
there you
studied
go.
All
so
your.
There is a blatant example of just, I like this person.
Mm-hmm.
Doug McLean, thanks, studied all your terrific moves over 9 years in Columbus. Well done.
Yeah.
And then yikes. Doug, thanks, appreciate your kind words. Good luck. Yeah, I think that's where emotion takes over. We all have that on Twitter. But what yeah. do we always say about
what Doug
tweet?
Was saying there it, by good luck is time will prove me right. And it might. It might. Panthers it might. Are doing something. You know, I said something in my video, and I didn't. I asked the question, but I didn't answer my own question because I wasn't sure. I asked who was or how what percentage of coaches are fired with a winning record?
Wasn't Randy Carlisle fired?
That's the last one I can think of.
He was fired while the Leafs were in a playoff spot. They were eighth place when they fired him.
And how did that work out?
They didn't make the playoffs. And thankfully, Steve Simmons tweeted, hey, just so you guys know, when Randy was fired, the Leafs were in the playoffs. But thanks, Steve. Appreciate
well, he also
that.
Tweeted Computer Boys.
Did he?
Yeah, he tweeted about the Computer Boys in Florida.
You know,
and there's another guy. Like,
I hate knowledge, don't you? I hate having every tool available to me to win. I hate it. I hate it. I hate
like,
so much.
What is this? The early like a movie in the early 90s? Like, hey there, nerd. Anyone you see on a computer.
You can type nerd
with a pocket protector and thick frame glasses and like teeth.
If you're not teaching your kids how to code at this point, you're doing them a disservice as a parent. I will be teaching my children to code.
Hey, the Computer Boys tweeted from a phone.
Who do you think wrote this?
How did you send that? Oh. How did you send that? You sent it from either a big computer or a little one.
Mr. Scientist.
Mr. Computer Boy. But that's an example. He is cheering for, whether he straight up says it or not, he's cheering for the Panthers' failure.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of people who are cheering for them to win. I mean, I'd be lying if I said I'm not sort of pulling for him. Not because of Reimer.
I'm totally
pulling
for him.
Because it'd be fucking hilarious.
You know who I'm pulling for? The Toronto Maple Leafs. You know who have based their system around an analytics driven system? Sorry, that was the worst way I possibly could have put that. Their system is based on analytics and a little bit of hockey knowledge. The Toronto Maple Leafs.
Yeah, but who is in the Leafs management? Lou Lamoriello. Mike Babcock counts.
Yep. Brendan Shanahan.
Mark Hunter. Brendan Shanahan, Brandon Pridham, Kyle Dubas. Now, people want to protect their relationships with Brendan Shanahan. They want to protect their relationship with Lou Lamoriello. They want to protect their relationships with Mark Hunter. You've seen people openly talk shit about Kyle Dubas. I've seen it.
Mm-hmm. Well, it'd be just very interesting what happens when Kyle Dubas takes over as general manager in a year and a half when Lou Lamoriello is slated to retire.
You never know. Let's not operate under the assumption that happens.
Well, that's what Lou said was going to happen.
Oh, okay, fair enough.
Lou said that when he got here. He's like, if Dubas is not ready to take over in 3 years, that's his fault.
Oh, okay. Well, there you go.
That's on him.
But people are openly talking shit about Florida because they don't know their management group. Therefore, their management group doesn't even help butter their bread. So fuck them. So fuck them. I'll talk shit about their stupid, shitty hockey team. Fine. Leafs, it's a little different.
I'd like to have Doug Cifu on, by the way.
Oh, I could probably arrange that.
Doug, if you're listening, love to talk to you.
I could probably arrange it.
Yeah? Doug Cifu?
I'm going to try. I'll try.
Okay.
Will you call him Seafood?
He's on the show. Excuse me, Mr.
Seafood. Seafood.
But
seafood.
I'll like trail off on the mic. So we have Mr. Seafood. Doug Cifu on the
podcast. I heard it's really fresh in that area.
Hey there, Doug Cifu really Linguini. my favorite thing to order. Dave Nonis got so much leash in Toronto. You know why? That guy leaks more than the Titanic, man. Oh, loose lips, Dave. Hey, little birdie told me that this trade might happen. Oh, little birdie told me. Oh, my God. All I'm saying is people are talking shit about the Panthers. One, because of their own ideologies when it comes to hockey. Two, they don't know people in Florida's management, and they don't feel like getting to know them.
Well, maybe as analytics, pro-analytics people, although I can't pretend to understand every graph that's thrown at me, because holy crap.
I'm going to go ahead and say I understand less than a quarter of them.
Yeah, I would say less than a quarter, too. And I don't even know what a quarter is, because I don't know what numbers are.
I think it's one-fifth.
But if somebody, by the way, tweets me the definition of what a quarter is, I'm gonna come after you, okay? I know what a quarter of something is. But I want to cheer for Florida. I'm pro Florida and I'm pro Leaf.
Yeah, I want the Panthers to succeed, and I want the Leafs to kick their ass every time.
Can we talk about what Andrew Berkshire had said to you, or should we just leave that? Came over.
Wait, which one?
You had a conversation with him, and he is a big fan of who?
Nazem Kadri.
Who?
Who? Who?
No, he's a big fan of what team?
Well, it's not the Montreal Canadiens anymore.
This is great, but...
Oh, the Leafs!
Okay, Steve's recall is the worst. I love him, but...
Like... You need to start making the baby, like, airplane sound. When you try to spoon feed me things. Holy shit.
Steve tells me all this great info, and I have to remember it all.
Adam just goes every show, and I'm the baby going, backing up from the spoon. Fuck, I stink. God!
What did he say to you?
He thinks the Leafs might have a top 5 second half, which I think that's pretty fucking optimistic.
Yeah, I would be like, okay.
Oh, yeah, that's a and lot. That's based on a lot of criteria. The number one thing to me is if they stay healthy. If you're not healthy, throw it out the window.
Mm-hmm. So if you're healthy, the good players they have.
I don't know about top five. I'd be very satisfied with top 10.
I'd be cool with top 15, to be honest.
Top half. I mean,
top half. Be top half.
Based on where they were
you
last
finished
year.
30th.
Hmm?
Is that a playoff spot? If they finish.
Yep. Top half?
Sniffing.
15, yeah.
It's sniffing.
Listen, if you finish top. Yeah, it's
top. Oh, like if that's where you end up? Yes.
If they have a top 15 second half, they're in the playoffs.
Unless that top 15 is stacked with Eastern teams.
Yeah.
Which, yeah, it's not a slam dunk, but it's very likely.
If you're top 10, second half, because they're not that far off.
Yeah.
Especially the Eastern Conference is pretty crowded.
It's tight. It's tight. They're like 11th in the East right now or something like that, but actual points back, they're like, what, three, four?
Yeah.
Three, yeah.
That went, you know, without the blow up in Winnipeg and the blow up, I forget where else.
Yeah. They started last game with, I think there were 4 points. Out of the playoffs and 4 points out of the basement. And like, well, welcome to November hockey. Like, that's what it is.
Yeah.
One final thing there. There's been like an attack on context in the NHL this year.
What do you mean?
And I saw a couple people tweet, and I guess this was a couple games ago. Leafs, after X amount of games last season, were this, this, and this. Leafs, after X amount of games this year, are this, this, and this. And it was like this year's Leafs were one win better. But the context is last year's Leafs actually weren't horrible until JVR got hurt. And then they stripped the team to the bone. Well, there's a little something that happened to last year's Leafs team.
I hate to remind everybody last year, but they were sniffing at a playoff spot into late January.
They were never going to make it, I don't think. But they were there.
There were some... And we were wondering out loud, well, okay, can you not screw this up for us? Because we'd like a top 10 pick. I remember talking about that. We'd really like a top 10 pick. Mm-hmm. Thank goodness they stripped it to the bone. But not Tim Murray strip it to the bone.
Yeah. If the Leafs, I would assume every 20-game stretch, again, barring injury, the Leafs get a little better. And if they do that, fuck, that's a playoff team. Or they're damn close.
Mm-hmm.
Damn close.
One thing we do need to talk about with the Leafs, which we didn't get to in the radio portion, and I did this sort of on purpose, is Garrett Sparks' suspension.
Oh, yeah.
Now, this is different because it's an indefinite suspension. Now,
he skated today.
Mm-hmm.
He skated today with the Marley scratches.
I gotta say, I don't think it's gonna last very long.
You think he's gone, eh?
No, I don't think the suspension's gonna last that long. They say indefinite because I'm sure because indefinite sounds a lot better than 4 games. Well, 4 games isn't enough. If you say indefinite, then there's nothing to compare it to. Yeah. Then it's whenever the hell we decide. And that's a power move by the Leafs, and that's setting an example not only for him but for anybody else that wants to go out on Facebook and say what he said. Now, we know what Garrett Sparks is. We know he's a pretty good guy. We know that he screwed up.
By now, does everyone?
Well,
know?
No. I think we should go. We should okay, contextually sure. use. We I don't want to attack context.
Oh shit!
Let's get into the context. So here's the deal. There's a goaltender's Facebook group that's closed. Correct.
Goalie gear sluts.
Is that what it's called?
Yes.
So and I believe he was one of the moderators on it and was
admins. Yeah.
Passionate about this group, and it would be guys talking about goalie equipment. Guys, saying, "Hey, we need a pickup goalie. We need this thing. We need this thing." Steve, I'll let you take it from here. What happened?
There was a disabled guy, I think mentally and physically, who wanted to be a goaltender, and I guess some people or maybe one person in the Facebook group thought this person was getting preferential treatment. And so
preferential treatment where?
In the Facebook group. Uh-huh. Like in terms of like Garrett Sparks, I think, was going to donate like a mask, like give this guy a mask, get him some equipment, get him on the ice, and let him live out his dream of being a goalie. Well, of course, you get one person, and it set Sparks off. Sparks were a flying, whoa. And basically he said something along the lines of, "I want to show up to open hockey wherever you live, drag you to center ice and beat the fucking shit out of you."
Mm-hmm.
And then he...
And then followed that up with...
"You're a little girl," or something like that.
So not only are we threatening physical assault, we're making sexist comments.
Well, Is it wrong to say that I assume that is what made people mad?
The sexism?
If all Sparks did was go, "I'm going to beat the fucking shit out of you," I don't think anyone cares. The Leafs do.
The Leafs do.
I don't think anyone else cares, though. I don't know.
Yeah.
He shouldn't have said either thing.
No.
Full stop.
We'll never.
Full stop.
Here's the deal.
There's no but.
There is no but. Listen, and here's the thing. We've all said dumb things that we are grateful are not out there in the public because, boy, that would be damaging to us. We've all done it.
We've all been.
Of us. And it's not, listen, there is no defending that. There is no defending that.
So someone tweeted me, they're like, "Well, you have a disabled sister. So like, how did this make you feel?" I'm like, look, Sparks shouldn't have said either thing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. However, I have been that mad. For the same reasons. If you go back and listen to the Angry Swedish Listener show, the famous show where we discover that I and everyone else in the hockey blogosphere were catfished. Oh, yeah, you too.
Mm-hmm.
You too. Jesse wasn't a part of the show just yet. Have you gone back and listened to that show?
I have, yeah, a while ago, but yeah, it's pretty intense.
So you have a pretty good ear for audio. How many cuts are in that show?
A few.
There's a few cuts because I said some crazy shit because I was angry.
Mm-hmm.
And Adam and Chris... It's still funny.
It was in my basement, by the way. I remember.
Oh yeah, this was in your mom's basement.
My mom's
boy.
Basement. I've never owned a basement.
and they were after the show. They were just like, "Okay, that's great. We're gonna cut a lot of that." And I was like, "Yeah, that's a good call. That's a good call. Sometimes, don't need to get the cops involved."
Yeah, sometimes that's the right thing.
Yeah, I mean, like, yeah. I don't need to get into the specifics of it, but this person. love for my own sister. They used that against me.
Yes.
And I'm getting mad thinking about it. I'm getting mad. And so this person clearly meant something to Sparks.
And this guy on Facebook went after the guy's disability.
Yeah. And fuck, man, like that, it drives you nuts.
Yes.
It drives you nuts. You can't do that. You just can't say what he said.
Especially, and people are like, well, what about this guy? Is he going to lose his job? I'm sorry. But if you are a Toronto Maple Leaf, you have, and Garret Sparks has put on the jersey, so yes, he's a Marley, but yes, he's been a Leaf.
Yeah, but all these dickheads have, like, I work at Future Shop or whatever in their Facebook bio. Like, you know what? Yes, Garret Sparks is a public figure, but fuck this guy.
Yes, also
fuck this guy. Where's the ramifications there?
But the point is, Steve. No, okay, I know. There is no.
I know the answers to my own questions.
The world isn't fair. And when you are a Toronto Maple Leaf, you cannot. I don't know why you're even on Facebook if you're a Toronto Maple Leaf.
That's a very good question.
Have Instagram where you post a picture of you with your dog, with your girlfriend at practice, whatever it is, but nothing about. Facebook is where good people go to become terrible people. Facebook is a miserable cesspool of shit. And honest to God, I wouldn't have it if I didn't have to. I have to have it for work. I have to reach out to people socially. I hate it. Hate it.
It's funny. Facebook's become where old people live.
Yeah. Miserable people.
I have it for, like, family. Otherwise, like, I would get rid of my personal Facebook in a heartbeat.
I did.
Yeah, people try adding me all the time. Don't. Don't. Angry Swedish listener, fuck that up for everybody. Don't.
You go ahead and add me. I don't care. Mine's a public profile. I don't discuss anything privately anyway.
Which is what mine used to be, but they had the maximum of the amount of friends you can have.
Oh, no, but you can get followers now.
Well,
I have 1,000 followers or something like that. Most of them are fake. Most of them are those fake. Do you ever get the request from the fake?
Well,
fake
a lot of Cuban
accounts?
Models like Hockey Talk. That's weird. I didn't know that. All right.
There's like a lot of people in their lingerie following me, and I'm like, yeah, no mutual friends? Yeah, you and I probably did. Oh, you've got two friends. Two friends? Okay, yeah, we're not friends. But
I always go to block those accounts, and there was one recently where I'm like, I'm going to block. Holy shit, that's a real person.
Yeah.
I was stunned.
So what I've done is I've left my page open, but I'm not really accepting friend requests anymore unless I know you or unless you are actually a podcast listener.
Know you qualifies as met you.
Met you. And because then I can verify it. But if you follow me, you can still comment on all my stuff and we can message back and forth. It just means that we're just not quote unquote friends, but you're following me. It's like Twitter.
Also, Garret Sparks. That was the point of this conversation.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Yeah, Garret Sparks, I think...
Thank you, Jesse.
Well, the point
Thank
is...
Thank you, Producy Shipman.
I think at the point... Yeah, you're right, Jess. I think with Garret, the Leafs did not have a choice. You left them with no choice. That was... Because
then you condone it.
Exactly. And if you're the Toronto Maple Leafs, you bet your ass you are suspending him. And you... I bet that conversation... Do you think...
It probably already bugged them. That he was an admin in a Facebook group called Goalie Gear Sluts.
I bet you Lou Lamoriello didn't know about it, too.
I bet you he did.
You think Lou Lamoriello would have allowed that to continue?
Lou Lamoriello.
Do you think?
Surely the GM
he
knows
told, I think he would have told
him
to shut
was going
down.
On, he probably wasn't going on Facebook himself going, what are Garret Sparks' likes? But I'm sure someone told him.
I bet he didn't know, because I bet you if Lou knew, Lou wouldn't have allowed it.
Okay. The Leafs are a social media savvy team now. The Marlies are fantastic. Follow their Instagram.
Are they on Facebook though? I mean, separate players. I just don't.
I don't know, but their Instagram's great. Their Snapchat's great. Their YouTube channel's great. I assume they're savvy enough to know what their players are doing. And also, it was out there. It wasn't a secret, and I think Sparks, like, advertises it, or has in the past. Like, if anything that any Leafs prospect has put on social media, they know. I'm certain they know.
There's a second part to this story that does not make what Sparks did any more acceptable.
Okay.
But I have to address this, and I won't address the name, but the way in which this was presented.
Because this person has been attacked.
Yes, the way in which this was presented, in my view, was highly irresponsible. Because initially, the way it was presented was without context. Now, that does not exclude, again, what Spark said. But when you take a comment like that, and you put it out onto the internet, especially Twitter, without context, people think that that's just the way the guy talks normally.
Now, knowing the context, is it okay?
No, of course it's not okay.
Now, does that make the presentation okay?
No.
Yeah, I would argue
both are
still
wrong.
No.
It's still, it's all wrong. And now this, and this is where it gets really bad, is this guy is apparently has dealt with threats. His girlfriend has apparently dealt with threats, which, by the way, is so unbelievably unacceptable and stupid and childish. You don't know Garret Sparks. You don't know the guy who posted it. Stay the fuck out of it.
And even if you do, fuck you.
Yeah.
You can't do that shit.
Yeah, you can't threaten people. And yeah. I hope
if you directly threaten someone,
their partner. What are you going after their partner for?
Yeah, of course. They had nothing to do with it. The police are very limited in what they can do when it comes to online stuff. If it is a direct threat, based on the information I've been given, no, they can.
You can go to jail.
If it's your public stupid idiot Facebook and you go, I am going to kill you or something like that. I am going to punch you in the face. That's a direct threat. That's definitely you. They go to your house. Hey, knock, knock, stupid. You can't do that. Anyway, sorry.
I think...
knock, knock, stupid. There's a cop drama tagline in there somewhere.
There's a lesson to be learned
detective.
Here.
Knock, knock, stupid.
Lesson to be learned here is if you are going to take... If you have a story like that...
Yeah.
Make sure... And the person who presented this then followed this up as they posted it with... I don't know the context.
It was kind of nonchalant.
No, and the thing is that I am all for learning experiences. So for him, I would chalk this one up to this is a learning experience.
I hope so.
You can't take stuff like that and present it without context. Now, beyond that, I feel terrible for him as well.
Because
it
was more than one person. It was more than one person who presented it without context.
Okay, fair enough. Yeah. Them. I will say them.
Yeah.
You can't do that. That you cannot do that. If you are a journalist, quote unquote journalist, it is your job. If that's a story, write a story about it.
Your answer should never be, I don't know.
Bingo. If it's a story, write the story. Gino if it's Retta, not a story, then don't post it.
Gino Retta, my first boss, used to get so mad when I would say, I'm not sure. Because when you say, I'm not sure, it's, I don't know. But that's only the first half. It's, I don't know, let me go find out.
That's why I tell people all the time.
And it used to drive me nuts, but fuck, he's right. I'm not sure is, I don't know.
Uh-huh. My favorite thing is, you know what? Let me get back to you on that. I don't know, let me get back to you on that.
We had a show, and I'm kind of throwing this guy under the bus, but whatever, he's retired and I still love him. We had our OHL guy, our OHL specialist, come on to our junior hockey show, and John Tavares... Oh, you know what it was? It was after the top prospects game. Zach Cassian takes John Tavares into the boards. Awkwardly, Tavares goes off. His shoulder's all fucked up. He slams his stick on the ice, doesn't play the rest of the third period. Oh my God, John Tavares just got knocked out of the top prospects game, which he probably shouldn't have even been playing in anyway. So we have our OHL guy come on, and he goes, yeah, I've been told that Tavares will not play this weekend. So we record our show Thursday nights. And it airs Thursday night, Friday night, Saturday, and Sunday in different markets across the entire country. Well, what the fuck does John Tavares do? The next night, he not only does he play, he scores a hat trick. And so we got an out-of-date shitty show nationwide.
Damn it. Hey.
He didn't know.
Now you have one twice a week.
He wasn't sure. Yeah. Hey, international.
International, you're
internet
right.
Internet national.
Yeah, so it's even bigger. That's good.
Yeah.
That's good.
So when we fuck up, there's higher stakes. Oh,
would you like a Holland update?
Oh
yes. Oh, yeah. I forgot about this. Thank you.
Christine Shilton from the Evil Network. She says, Kristen. Peter Holland wants to play, wanted to go on Leafs trip, but opted not to after talking to Lou and his agent. Trader... / waivers could be coming.
Wow. Waivers, eh? Uh-huh. He'd get claimed, wouldn't he?
What do you guys think of that?
I mean, the writing's been on the
sounds
wall.
Like
I don't
waivers.
Know why they re-signed him.
I don't know either. That was the biggest surprise of the offseason for me. Besides Matt Martin, one of the bigger surprises. I think they waive him.
If I was Peter Holland, I'd be pretty upset too. Mm-hmm. I thought he played a hell of a game on, who's last
well,
game
maybe
they
that's,
played?
Maybe then that'd be good for him because maybe
Capitals?
It'll be a trade.
Capitals, thank you. Holy shit.
Maybe
sorry.
It'll be a trade.
I hope so. He's a player. I think he's an NHL player. I don't know if he's a fantastic one. He's one. I think, well, and there must have been a conversation. I would assume there would have been a conversation with Babcock because I would assume Holland would play at least one of the three Western games. Mm-hmm. Edmonton, maybe he doesn't. You put Nylander in the lineup. Maybe someone comes out against Calgary because, you know, back-to-backs, and you can. You have all these spares. I would assume Frankie Corrado would play the Calgary game too. And then, I don't know, maybe he doesn't play Vancouver. But now, see, this puts the Leafs in a shitty position, though, because they're on a road trip, remember. What happens if a forward gets hurt? They don't have any spares.
Call someone up.
They might have to.
What would be the problem?
I guess Josh Levo is going to magically have to.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you know what? This is probably going to get taken care of soon. Because, like, let's say Nylander's injury acts up again, or something happens to someone else. Like, what are you going to do? Put Frankie Corrado on the wing? Or Martin Morenson on the wing? You have two spares.
Hey, neither of them are forwards. Playing. That'd be good.
Yeah, I know. Oh, he's probably like, dude, do it. Send me out there. Fuck, I'll feed Matt Martin all game. Mitch Martin or Matt Martin. But yeah, he's putting the Leafs in a tough position by not going on this road trip. Or maybe they said straight up, I don't know. This is going to have to solve itself pretty quick. Because if someone gets hurt, they don't have any replacements for the next three games.
But you can call someone up so easily.
Yes, but from Toronto. So they're in Toronto.
Uh-huh.
I don't know if the Marlies play tonight or not. I think they do. And then you got to fly them.
Oh, man.
You don't want to put them in that position.
It's a solvable problem.
It's a solvable problem.
This is not a problem. Yeah. I love you, man, but I'm on the other side of this one.
You don't want to drag a guy across Canada.
Oh, God.
You're acting like this is no big deal.
Steve, I lived in Calgary. I've done the flight. It ain't that bad, man.
Did you do the flight after playing the Albany Devils?
No, I didn't.
Or
the team
whoever?
That beat me in the playoffs last year, who I definitely should want revenge against. Didn't the Albany Devils beat them?
Marley's 1-7, baby.
Oh,
it was the Hershey
was.
Bears.
It was the Hershey Bears. The Hershey Bears
friggin' wiped the floor with them.
Yeah, they did.
I don't think an NHL team having 12 forwards on a three-game road trip is something to be concerned about.
Jesse, what will they do? He'll have to walk.
It's not ideal.
He'll have to port talk.
Fuck you guys.
Have they invented planes yet?
No, they haven't. They have invented planes. It still takes 3.5 hours to get there.
It takes the steam locomotive 3 days to cross the country on the John A. McDonald Railroad.
Friends like these, who needs internet? Trolls.
But how
fuck you guys.
Do they call someone up from their AHL team?
Especially with a team like the Leafs that are broke and could not afford to get the plane, their own plane to fly them out there.
Have friggin' like Brendan Leipzig parachuted in, drop from like a B-52 if they wanted to. They can afford it.
They can do that.
No question.
With fireworks. With fireworks.
Yeah.
Not what's going to happen with Peter Holland. It's how do they get a Marley to the West Coast?
For an injury that hasn't happened yet.
You guys are fucking dead.
Especially if Levo's on it. So you need two injuries. Because Levo's not injured. No. So you need two injuries.
Steve checked out.
No, sorry. James Marlowe. Because I'm looking for... when it comes to this stuff, I assume there's going to be an update. Plus, I also just want to get out of this ass kicking.
guys, can anybody suggest, by the way, if you're listening to this show, I want you to tweet us and suggest the various creative ways that the Leafs could get a Marley out to the Leafs on the West Coast.
A bunch of balloons like an up.
And also, how Eastern do we sound right now? All the West Coast people are like, are you kidding me? Are you freaking kidding me? We're not on Mars.
Steve thinks so, apparently.
If a guy gets hurt tonight, they don't find out the player can't play till tomorrow, they gotta have a fucking... Fuck you guys.
Oh, no, and then they'd have to fly him out there, and maybe the guy they flew out there doesn't get to play. Oh, no.
And you know what he'll have to do? He might have to play hockey.
Oh, no, he might have to fly home. Can you imagine?
Is that difficult for him to play hockey?
Yes!
Are they hockey players?
He'll have
players?
To take the official Toronto Maple Leafs tricycle home.
And that with chrome wheels.
With chrome wheels. Spinners.
You best believe.
Spinners.
Oh, fuck yeah.
Loose face, just spinning on a rim.
Yeah, from like a 2003 music video.
Does anybody make rims here? Can we make Lou Lamorello spinners? Because I would put that on my car. I would so put that on my car. Anyway.
With L's.
Yeah.
L's. James Myrtle, who, by the way, congratulations on your new job there, buddy.
With the Athletic.
I wonder if we can get him on the show again.
I think this means we can have James on the show again.
Because he doesn't work for the evil people now. He works for the Athletic. He tweets, the Peter Holland stuff sorry, this Peter Holland stuff with the Leafs has been brewing for a long time. Mm-hmm. Was waived in the summer, which I forgot about. Minutes from arbitration hearing, now benched. Yeah.
We kind of had a source tell us, and I won't reveal, that they thought Holland would be gone before the end of last season.
Yeah. Oh, I mean, that's what I thought, too. I don't know. I don't get it. Maybe we can ask CJ about it when he comes on the show next show.
Maybe we can.
But we won't have Jesse?
Nope, I will not be there.
No. Next show, Jesse will be here.
Yeah.
It's Monday show next week. Steve missed all of that. He's looking at his phone.
Because Platinum Seat Ghosts, a.k.a. Third Period Suits.
What are they saying?
An interesting thought on Holland, and I guess I can stop reading tweets after this. Hope Corrado follows this example, referring to Peter Holland. Can't let your career get destroyed when you're at that age.
Wait a second. Do you think Peter Holland just said, I'm not going?
He's not fucking playing. Like, he
hold on.
He and Corrado are on one-year deals, not playing. How do you make your next contract when there's nothing to base it on?
Mm-hmm. Good boy.
It's true. They both got to get the fuck out of there.
Yeah.
It is that. Like, Martin Morrison has played. He will likely play again. Corrado is the eighth. That's what he is. He's the eighth guy. Eighth out of eight.
Is Corrado... Oh, man. Anyway, yeah. We're not even going to get into that. Forget it. I was just going to leave it.
What?
It's frustrating. Corrado's frustrating to me. It's really frustrating.
Why is it frustrating?
Sorry, we don't know... I mean, okay, they know... They seem to know what they have in him... Or they think they have, but I guess we've just seen him so little, we don't know what we have.
Mm.
And they're so quiet about it that it's frustrating. It's like, what? Tell me why he's not playing. Like, if you're the coach.
They think he's eighth. That's why. Yeah. That's the answer. Sorry, I'm standing because I have to pee so bad.
Me too. I got to pee too. Well, you know what? Maybe this is a good time.
Jesse got me this giant tea that I drank for the entire show.
We will pee. Thank you. And Jesse will play the press conference intro, and then we'll be back magically. As soon as the press conference intro is done.
Great. I call a close one.
The Steve Dangle Press Conference.
Did you play the music?
Yeah, we played the music. That was good pee. That was a good pee.
That was a great pee.
Oh,
I feel so much better.
Well, you know what? It's nice. I got to tell you, it's so nice to have this this amount of time.
Yeah, you know what? The Leafs, who cares if Peter Holland's not on the road trip? Sorry, it's just everything's more frantic when you got to pee.
Yeah.
What the fuck are they going to do? They don't have this guy. Oh, my God. You know, fuck Peter Holland.
How you feeling about the flight thing now?
I don't think it's a big deal.
It's not.
Although I will.
But I love you.
I am totally just kidding when I say fuck Peter Holland. Because he's a great guy.
Mark Masters says.
We've been hard on you, buddy.
Babcock opens media session by announcing Peter Holland and his agent met with Lamorello and decision was made not to come on this trip. That's how Babcock opened the...
He's going to go for nothing, eh?
Yeah. Yeah, of course. And you know what? I mean, honestly, what could you possibly get?
On one hand, I don't like what the Leafs have done with a few players. On the other hand, they have their way, and they are weeding out everyone who's not hip to it.
Yeah.
They're weeding them out. You don't want to be here? Get the fuck out.
Well, and
you don't want to play by our rules? Get the fuck out. Frankie Corrado's going to go for nothing. Peter Holland's going to go
trade
for nothing.
Trade for future considerations.
Garret Sparks is going to go for nothing.
Find a taker.
You know what? You know what's been amazing doing these trade tree articles is how many future considerations are just...
They're just forgotten about.
They just never... They don't give a shit.
At this point, I feel bad for... I've met Peter. He's a really nice dude.
Yeah. The joke about he is always at every community function... It's not a joke. It's true. He's at everything with a smile on.
Yep. He's a good team player. It's just a guy that just is not working out here. And you know what? This is a team that
I think it's not that he hasn't worked out. It's just he's not in favor with the coach.
I think the Leafs have a bit of an embarrassment of riches right now in terms of guys in their early 20s. And I think they're going to play the best ones.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I think it is.
Mm-hmm.
Straight up.
Mm-hmm.
And no, with no disrespect to Peter, I don't think he's one of those guys.
Well, and it's also the Leafs prefer. Well, Babcock prefers Ben Smith to Peter Holland. That's what it is.
And as the head coach, he's perfectly allowed to do that.
And apparently, Nylander is the fourth line center tonight against Edmonton.
So probably they're limiting his minutes then.
I don't know. I don't know what the hell's.
do you guys want to check in with our favorite website, Narcity?
Oh, my God.
Okay.
Do you know Narcity?
I do, but I can't remember if I like
they
it or don't.
They are the kings of the listicle.
Oh, okay.
They are the...
I thought you were going to say Mike.com. I was like, I don't have the strength!
No,
Let
no.
Let me go!
They are the... Well, I remember one last year. 25 things only Toronto girls do in the summer.
Oh, are they the 40 things only Jackasters employees?
Yes,
oh.
Yes. So I love a good listicle. All right,
40 things right. Only you will know if you work the night shift at Chopper's Drug Mart.
I remember I texted Caprice and
music
I was like,
videos with Drake.
Remember I was texting Caprice about the Jackaster stuff and yeah. I was like, hey, is any? She's like, none of this is. Yeah. Actually true.
So
like,
as a married man and as a man who's almost married,
mm-hmm.
I think we should take a look at Brooklyn's list of 12 pickup lines that actually worked on me from Narcity.
Is Brooklyn
the person?
Brooklyn is it in
is
Brooklyn?
The
oh, I thought it was in Brooklyn. I'm like, if it's in Brooklyn, then I don't know.
These are Toronto pickup lines.
Oh, okay. Oh, Toronto-centric pickup lines? Okay.
Yeah, so Brooklyn wrote this
article. Hey, baby, want to go to Taste of the Danforth? Like, what the fuck?
Her first thing was hitting her with a joke. The pickup line was pretending to bump into her. Ooh, ouch. Looks like I'm going to need your name and number for insurance purposes. That worked on Brooklyn.
Well, Brooklyn, I mean, you
know
have
what,
very low standards.
Hey, listen, if you are able to successfully pull that off in a funny way, I could see that working. I can see that working.
If you did that and were super hot, yeah, I could see that working.
That's the thing. You have to be handsome. Yeah. Otherwise, you're a fucking creep. Otherwise, you're a fucking creep and you're a weird dude and somebody should call the cops.
We have a lot of male listeners and we're going to assume the majority of them are average because that's what average is, right? Average is average.
Yeah.
Okay. So,
I mean, logically, yes.
As an average dude, you wouldn't recommend that pickup line?
I think here's the thing. Women see, I think the way women judge attraction and the way men judge attraction is very different. Like women obviously find physical features attractive, but I always find that women's, you know, you could have two best friends and they like completely different guys. But if you show a guy, if you show most guys a picture of, I don't know, Jennifer Lawrence, most of them are going to be like, yeah, she's hot. But if you show some women Brad Pitt, they go crazy. Other women, they're like, oh no, not a chance in hell.
They always pick out like weird things.
Yeah, like
his earlobes.
They're just. I think they're more specific. Does that make sense?
Yes. Fine. Yeah.
Less united in what they find attractive versus what men find attractive.
A little bit more niche.
Totally. So I think if you're attractive to her and this is totally chance, yeah, you can pull that off.
And number two, acting like you've already met her. Oh hey, nice to see you again.
That's lame.
How are you?
That worked on Brooklyn.
This worked
Stop
on Brooklyn.
It. Brooklyn,
so
stop it.
You are making it so that girl's first impression of you is what? Who the fuck? What? Huh?
Yeah, have I ever told you about... Oh, okay. So in Calgary, obviously, Steve, this is going to be foreign to you because, I mean, you met the love of your life at 19.
I'm super down with that,
but,
by the way.
Yeah.
It's great.
You missed a lot of terrible moments. But
oh,
some
I
of
got
them
in under the wire before Tinder. Thank shit. Thank God.
My roommate once... hooked, basically broke the ice with a girl who we didn't know by tapping her on the shoulder and saying, hey, you met Adam? And then literally walked off. And that's what it was. It was like, hey, we're because I looked at her. I was like, oh, she's cute. And he's like, we're going to play the have you met game. And then he was basically like, he tapped her and he said, hey, have you met Adam? And then he walked off to the bathroom. And I was like, Adam, nice to meet you.
You met a potential mate without the use of a social media?
Yeah.
Ooh, how vintage.
Crazy. I know, right? Dust that one off for you.
And number three, comparing her to someone famous. You look exactly like blank.
I wouldn't.
Celebrity.
I wouldn't.
That
that's a terrible idea.
Not a good pickup line?
Terrible, terrible, terrible idea.
All right.
What if they hate that?
Left.
What if they hate that? I remember like Blake, who was on our show for a long time, Jesse, she got constantly compared to Katy Perry. Most people would take that as a compliment.
You are white with black hair.
Essentially, that's what it was. And she was like, no, I am nothing like Katy Perry. I look nothing like Katy Perry.
Oh, who... Okay, so someone tweets me the other day, and they're like, you look like Zach Hyman. And then someone goes, no. I say, you know what? I haven't gotten that before, but I've gotten Ben Smith. And then someone goes, really? I see Connor Carrick. And I'm like, oh, you've just established I'm a white person with brown hair. That's all you've done.
Jesse gets it the most out of all of us.
Yeah, Dalton Pompeii. But it's Dalton Pompeii. It's one person, though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's always, holy shit, you look like Dalton Pompeii. Man, there's a video... there's a video where Munenori Kawasaki is, they're celebrating one of their wins, and he's just like, I'm drunk. And Pompeii comes from behind, and he's just like, monkeys never cramps. He's making fun of Kawasaki.
Yeah.
And I was like, that's Jesse. That's just Jesse. That's Jesse wearing goggles.
There's some mannerisms there.
Oh, yeah. Monkeys never cramps.
Here's the thing. If you compare somebody to somebody else before you've met them, you have no idea how they feel about that. There are certain people out there that don't care. You could tell me I look like whoever you want. You could tell me I look like a rock. I'd be like,
you okay, look like a geodude.
Okay, whatever. But there's certain people that take that extremely seriously and are super offended by it. I don't understand why. I think because there are people who have attach different emotions to different things than I do. I just wouldn't walk down that road. Serious, I hate to suck the fun out of this, but I wouldn't do it.
Here, I say do it, but put my twist on it and just be like, you know, you're looking at a pretty girl and you go, hey, has anyone told you you look just like Chris Pratt? You know? Just, huh? What? Hey, and then my name is Ryan.
It's a good thing works. You met SL Young.
I don't think that would go over well.
Yeah, single guy. Does that work over well?
I don't think that would go over well at all.
Yeah, that's the joke. Look, they're not all going to be home runs.
Okay? I have to say, when I was on Tinder, Steve was great with opening lines.
I just think great. It's really hard to fly out to Calgary.
You'd be
shoulder tindering is the best because there's no stakes.
Yep. It's.
I think a flight out to Calgary is really hard to get. And, you know, everything else has just been uphill.
Yeah. From there.
I think lots of things are difficult. Tinder, flights to Western Canada. Mostly those things.
You mean Mars? Yeah. Don't you mean Mars?
Number four is offering her a drink.
No. Nope. Nope. Don't buy a stranger a drink.
Unless you have the money, I suppose.
Again, to pull that off. They have to find you attractive. And not everybody's going to find you attractive right off the bat. They don't know you.
My wife, prior to meeting me, I fucking hope, used to just go to the bar and get free drinks.
Caprice used to do that too.
Used to just scam free drinks.
Yep. Oh, they do it all the time. They're like, literally.
Shameless.
Yeah.
They don't care.
I mean, it's fine. Good for them. But it's one of those things that, like, I had a rule when I was single. Don't buy a stranger a drink. They don't know where that's coming from, so it comes across as creepy.
Drink
don't accept it. But don't. Why would you waste your money on somebody who could just walk away? Go, great, thanks, walk away. No. You want to be invested in them, and at least having a conversation with them, and you'll be like, hey, you know what? I'm going to grab a drink. Do you want one? Then it's good.
Yeah. Well, and when I was at the age that I could afford it, when I was at bar age, like I couldn't afford that shit.
Yeah. Yeah, it's also very expensive.
Oh my God, this person just took 5 of the 40 remaining dollars I have. They took 1/8 of my money. Fuck.
Number 5 that worked on Brooklyn is giving her a backhanded compliment. That shirt would look better on you if you were taller.
I have actually heard from many people that works.
Yeah?
It's surprising to me, but I have heard that
that's
works.
That's a pickup line? Or is that just that's not a backhanded compliment?
You insult her.
No, that's not even a backhanded. That's a terrible example. That is not a backhanded compliment. That is a straight up insult.
It's a backhanded compliment.
There's no. What's the compliment?
She's wearing a nice shirt.
You have to say
It'd
that.
Be like,
then.
Hey, your shoes would look great on a different girl.
That doesn't mean that is an insult. If you say those are some great shoes, they'd look better on someone with bigger feet. Then that's a backhanded compliment.
Brooklyn.
No, Brooklyn's had an insult work on her.
Yeah,
now you have to say that is a nice shirt. It will look better on someone taller. That's a backhanded compliment.
That's her example.
Is that what she said?
That shirt would look better on you if you were taller.
Insult.
No,
The thing that makes that not a insult is that turns it into a backhanded compliment is if you say that's a great shirt. It would look better on. But if you just say that shirt would look better on someone taller, then it's just a straight up insult.
What if you just go up to people and call them ugly?
Hey there, bad breath. And then when they get mad and go, what? Just go, ugh.
What's up, stinky gland? Just terrible.
Stinky gland. Gland?
Glands in them. Saliva glands. Sorry.
What?
Did I Adam Wild that? I went, sorry.
Number six is questioning her decisions. So, what is a girl like you doing in a place like this?
That's not really, that's not questioning her.
Well, that example's terrible, but I could see, like, she could, you could be in a conversation with somebody and be, oh, well, I guess this is an icebreaker, right? This is a pickup line?
Yeah, first line.
I guess you could say, like, you could walk up to somebody and be like, oh, you ordered a, let's say, Cosmo. Oh, ordered a Cosmo, eh? How's that working out for you? Like, something fun like that where you're being playful. I get that.
I don't even have a comment. Like, thank God every day I never had to do this.
It can be fun. It's not all that bad.
It sounds horrible.
It's not something something I want to do again, but I had fun. It's fun.
Yeah. Number seven is being adorable. You're so good looking, I actually just forgot my pickup line.
That normally does work on people. That's a good
line.
That's
not a bad line.
Yeah,
that's not bad. Work.
Jesse,
yeah. I'm with that.
You think you can try that?
I will not try anything.
Jesse can try any one of these.
And get away with all of them.
Yeah. Nope. I will try this one.
Hello, tall, handsome man. Hello. Oh, my God. Dalton Pompey bought me a drink. Holy shit. I get to go on a date with a blue jay.
You know where it's unfair?
See, that would work.
Here's a great pickup line. Number seven. I'm Dalton Pompey.
You know what we should do?
What?
We should go out to a bar one night and just and have Jesse be Dalton Pompey.
For Halloween.
Yeah.
Actually, you know what I mean?
And then we can contact Dalton Pompey and he can switch in.
I don't know if he'd be cool with this.
I don't know if Dalton Pompey would like any of those, yeah.
I think he'd find it funny.
Number eight is hitting her with a headline. Hi, my name is blank, but you can call me tonight.
Oh, my God.
That's just a cheesy line.
It's cheesy. You have to be adorable if you want to pull that off. You got to know your adorable scale.
That line would 100% work at Croc Rock.
Yes. Croc Rock being a
cougar bar. How does
the
a place
banging MILF bar in Toronto?
Wow.
I have seen some ridiculous shit in that place.
Croc Rock? Okay, here's the thing. If you're in Toronto, or if you are ever in Toronto, go to Crocodile Rock. Wait till about 2:30 when the lights come on.
Yes.
And watch who's going home with who.
Oh yeah.
Oh baby. Because that's when people are like, well, it's anywhere from midnight, because some people like to go to bed early. Midnight to about 2:30. Just watch who's walking out the door. Fun times.
That's a fascinating, it's a good place to people watch.
Odd rule. You can't, there's two floors. There's like
two floors.
Three floors.
Three floors.
Three floors. You can't bring your drink up from one floor to the next.
Oh.
To the third one.
Really?
Oh my God.
Yeah.
You can take two pitchers like I did and dance on the stage. That's cool.
Quad fist at a bar in Guelph.
But no, at Croc Rock, I was like dancing with two pitchers on the stage. Like it was my younger years, but we did that. Myself and our friends Derek and Andy, we did it.
Yeah.
But you can't walk up some stairs?
The worst thing is when there are girls up on that platform area where I assume you were dancing.
That's where I was dancing.
And then a guy tries to go up and join them, and then he just ends up dancing by himself there on the
stage.
That's
why you need to do what we used to do and boo them loudly.
Yeah.
Boo!
I didn't get booed when I was up there. I guess I had the moves.
We booed when guys got on the bus in Guelph.
Yeah, that was
every
funny.
Time a girl got out, yay!
Guy gets
on boo.
next pickup line.
Number nine is asking her a question she can't say no to. Hey, do you have a couple of minutes for me to hit on you?
She can fully say no to that.
Brooklyn didn't.
The examples are bad. You have to, you can, that is a yes or no answer.
Okay.
Back end a compliment. Nope. Straight up insult.
Brooklyn,
yes or no question. Nope.
You're decent in theory, poor in execution there. That is, that worked on you?
Well,
I
think that's a
ask
good
me
line.
Questions I can't say no to, because apparently you can't.
If you are goofy enough, adorable enough to pull that off, again, you got to know your adorability scale.
We're talking about the average guy here, Adam, not the guy with super personality like you.
Certain guys are some. I am the average guy. Believe me, very average.
10 out of 10.
Here's a Jesse pickup line.
Hey,
look at this. Look at this.
You know what? Actually, Jesse doesn't even say anything.
Yeah,
that's his pickup line.
Because he gives him the steamy Drake eyes.
Because honestly, yeah, Jesse's got this thing where he's quiet. Sometimes I'll walk in and be like, hey, man, how are you? Is it good? Mm-hmm. Like, are you okay? Like, I'm instantly more interested. And he's like, yeah, I'm fine. What's up? But because Jesse's quieter than us, he's more mysterious.
People will just want to, like, feel your sweater. See,
you
can
grow a full beard. We can't.
Grow a full beard.
You could. You're
Stroke
Italian.
His beard. What?
You could grow a full beard.
I think I can now.
I think he
I
got
couldn't
the
before.
He got the sweat gland. He didn't get the hair.
Oh, no, I got the hair everywhere but my face.
I love you. I'm going to give you another. I love you.
Steve, out of 10, how hairy is your back?
Upper knot, but I got the Jeremy Hotz tuft above my ass on the back.
You know what I've got?
That's how it calls it, my tuft.
I've got goes, under oh. my I got it under my shoulder blades.
The yeah, weird. I don't have that.
What's no, up with that? That?
I don't know. Why, I think that's one of those things there? You have or don't. I don't have that.
And I got back. A little bit on top of my shoulder. Anyway,
I don't have any
I'm
of that.
Have that. I have that stuff.
But I have hair pants.
Ripped off. So, you have hair pants?
I have hair pants.
Oh. I have hair pants too.
Oh, you mean like, no, pants.
Have I ever told you the time I tried to...
What?
I'm going to tell this
you
story.
You shave your ass?
Yeah, I did.
There you go.
All right, so I...
How hard was that?
I don't know. I'm not sure what it's offending people anymore, so I'm afraid... I'm hesitant to tell these stories, but when I was...
When, you should tell this on Kiss. Are you kidding me?
Yeah, I guess I could tell this on Kiss.
Tell this to Dina.
Yeah. Well, I'm sure Dina would like that. No. So... I don't know if anybody else experienced this, just Steve, if you did, Jesse, if you did, but when you have hair pants, when you first get your hair pants, you're not used to sitting on your hair pants. So
it hurts a little bit, and it's itchy as shit.
Itchy, so incredibly itchy.
We're just open. We had such good hockey talk for so long, and now it's just so swamp ass.
No, well, it wasn't even that. It was like I remember being in Dragon Boat in school, and we'd train in the school pool.
Oh, the worst.
And the chlorine would dry it out. Plus, you got hair going in, so it's very, very itchy. When I would get to French class, and I'd be like, with my butt, like all over the place. Like, trying to scratch it on the thing, and it was just like I'd be like, and then I'd literally go to the bathroom just so I could scratch my cheeks. Like, it was so bad. So first year university,
I am just patiently waiting for this conversation to go too far, because there's a point, it's coming.
Well, no, first year university.
So then my friend came in and scratched my ass for me, and I was like, Steve, knock that off.
We should start a podcast.
Let's go back to math.
Let's never speak of this again. No. So I remember going, I was sitting in university and I was not used to my hair pants. And
Jesse's face. Tell the story, Adam.
I'm trying to tell it. I can't. Your damn face.
Jesse's face.
And I was really uncomfortable and I couldn't pay attention. So I went home and I was like, screw it. I'm going to shave it. So
you just stick a razor blade in your asshole.
Well, not in it. It's just the cheeks. It wasn't even in it. It was just on the cheek.
For the youngins listening, don't do that.
Well,
don't do that.
This is an explicit podcast, okay?
You want to make a problem worse? Shave it.
Yeah.
Don't do that.
Yeah. So I thought, I'm like, okay, I'll get rid of the hair. I'm going to try it on one cheek. So not only am I going to do this, I'm only going to do it on one side to see if it... Because I wanted to have a tester. Here's the hair pants side. Here's the naked butt side. What side is going to be more comfortable? So
you have an ass made for a Billy Mays commercial.
Alanis? Well, factors into this.
Oh, no.
So hang on. So I'm shaving it, and I'm doing it stupidly, not in front of a mirror. I did it in the shower, and I had a brand new razor. So we're talking sliced and diced, baby. Like I
Oh man.
And then so the next day I go to school and the hair is coming back in. So it is itchy and uncomfortable on a level that I cannot even explain. So I get home and I'm like obviously walking around the house like being a little bit weird. My mom's like, "What did you do? What happened?" And I said so I had to explain this to her. I'm like, "Mom, I couldn't sit still in class because my hairy butt wouldn't let me because I wasn't used to it." And then she's like, "Let me see." I'm like, "Mom, you're not going to see this."
Oh my God.
So I'm like, I can't show you this. And then she's like, no, you got to show me just so I can have a look because you can't see back there, whatever. So I'm like, shut her down. And I don't think my mom's ever laughed so hard in my life. It was like the face of the moon. It was just terrible shit all over. So anyway, moral of the story here, when you're 18, don't shave your bum and then show your mother and because it was weeks and weeks and weeks. Not till just the hair grew in, which by the way was awful, to when the scabs cleared up. Like, I had sliced myself, man. It was bad. It was bad.
This story started, and I'm like, this will be fun. And then he's talking about carving his ass and showing his mom. And
listen, we've all been there with things.
No.
Listen, but you...
No, I've never shaved my ass and showed my mom.
So, Peter Holland...
Take me seriously.
What just happened?
Hey, by the way, this is supposed to be the press conference. What are the rest of the pickup
lines? I can't wait for Twitter every time you offer an opinion. Yeah, well, you shaved your ass.
That's what it's going to be.
Adam, now. I'm so proud of you.
What's the matter with you?
What's the, Jesse?
That's an all-timer. Is that leading off the next best of, Steve?
Yes. Yes.
I think it has to.
I think that was the point in my life, too, where my mother was just disappointed with me. Like, all the time. Because I was partying a little too hard, my grades sucked, and that sort of thing. I feel like that might have been rock bottom, where my mother was like,
I think it might have been smooth bottom.
I've raised a degenerate for smooth. Oh, Jesus.
Number 10.
Let's finish this up. This drive's going to take fucking forever.
Number 10 is staring her down from across the bar.
That's weird. Stop doing that.
Yeah, there's great advice.
Here, come on. Let's go make
it. Also breathe super
heavy. Let's go stare at the camera.
Number 11 is complimenting her outfit. I have those exact same shoes.
That's not a compliment. That's a relation.
That's being adorable. Because no, you don't.
It's not a compliment at all.
Oh, but if she's wearing heels and you go, oh, I have those exact same shoes, then it's kind of funny.
But it's not a compliment.
Yeah, it's not.
Yeah, no, it's.
But if you just say,
that's
hey,
just being adorable.
Some people take it the wrong way. But if you ever say, hey, listen, not to be weird, but I think you look really fantastic in that. Have a great night. Leave it at that. I think that's classy. Some people will not like that. Most people will be fine with that. And it's like, hey, if you're at the bar, you're there probably trying to look good, right? Chances are. Although I don't know. Everybody's offended by everything these days. So I don't know. But I feel like if you say that to somebody in the most classy, non-creepy way possible, just say, listen, I just want to tell you, I think you look fantastic. What you're wearing looks great. I hope you have a great night. I just had to tell you.
Here. Try to pick me up. Just start with hello.
Hello.
What?
I actually like recoil. That's why I'm just
throwing my drink.
All right.
Last one. Blaming it on your friends. My buddies bet me that I wouldn't be able to start a conversation with the most beautiful girl in the bar.
If you're 20, that works. If you're 25, that no longer works. If your buddies bet you, all they hear is at 25, 26 years old, they start to hear, buddies bet you. Oh, great. What else are they going to bet you when I start dating you? No.
Yeah, my buddies.
At 20, whatever. 20's 20, right? But if you start to get more mature, like if you're 30 and you're pulling that line, yeah, no. There's a reason you're single.
I'm going to go with, I just don't know.
But that's common sense, though.
Yeah, sure. I think. Dude, I'm so happy I got to avoid all this shit.
Do we want a question?
Yeah.
One. Fuck.
XThunder1022 on Reddit writes, you guys really showed me a whole side of hockey that I never even thought of before. I always loved the game, but could never skate, so I was stuck playing ball hockey. I always thought that in order to get a job in sports journalism or working with a team, you had to have hashtag played the game. No. Steve showed me otherwise, and I have to thank you for that.
There you go.
I've become really interested in stats and writing for a company like Sportsnet, or even work for an NHL team. I turned 15 in October. So although I'm young, I know this is the right thing for me.
Good for you.
I want to apply at the Giants, the local WHL team, as an intern.
Oh, Vancouver.
But my parents want me to get a job that pays. Any advice there?
Do both.
Yeah. Try real hard to do both.
You do need to get a job that
your
pays.
Your intense partying years are ahead of you still. You're 15.
Mm-hmm.
See if you can do both. It'll be super valuable to you, mm-hmm. and it'll instill a work ethic in you at a really young age,
mm-hmm.
Which is great.
And you'll understand. The best thing about working for free for me was the value of, ever since I've been like, wow, I'm so thankful, so grateful, because I wanted this so badly, I was willing to work for free for it. And I was willing to work other jobs at the same time. I did it.
Yeah. I think unpaid jobs should not exist. I think everyone should be paid, but they're still there.
You can be paid in experience.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's possible to be paid in experience, especially
in
when you're 15.
Amount of time. Yep, I agree.
Yeah, like
you got to set limits on
the problem.
Like,
school.
What was it? What was it? Diddy's company that got sued for somebody had to work for free for like 2 years?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah,
that's obnoxious. That's crazy.
That was ridiculous. Like $1 million company.
Yeah.
That was stupid.
Yeah, that's great. That's great.
Awesome.
I mean, I would tell you to do both simply because all that money that you make at your job that doesn't actually pay that much money, it goes so much further when you're 15.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You feel like a millionaire when you get like $100 at 15.
I went to McDonald's, I worked at McDonald's for like 2.5 months when I was 15 or 16. And I took all the money I made and I went to New York.
Wow.
With it because I didn't. What did I have to spend money on?
Remember when $100 felt like $100?
I walked to school, I didn't take the bus.
$100 now feels like $15.
Yeah.
It feels like $10.
Yeah, you're just like, whatever, I got honeys all over this.
This cost a couple hundred, though.
Yeah. Oh, I'm still broke. I'm as broke as I was when I was 15. But but now $100 is like, I spend $100 as regularly as I would spend 15.
Yeah, I took basically every dollar I made at McDonald's and went to New York.
That's good.
On a school trip. Like, I paid for the thing.
Yeah.
Myself. That was
and
crazy.
And you, what mode of transportation did you use to get there?
A bus.
Oh.
Hmm.
It took 9 hours.
Hmm.
So what you're saying is Peter Holland or someone from the Marlies needs to take a bus to Calgary?
Well, I mean, maybe a taxi, but I hope the Leafs pick it up.
Go shave your ass.
Linesman 21.
Go shave your ass.
That's a good comeback.
Go shave your ass.
Linesman 21 says, for Steve. With your LFRs going to 10 seasons, that means players drafted in the most recent draft were 8 when you started your videos. So how many of those players do you think grew up with YouTube and watching your videos? Because they were 8 years old.
I think a few of them.
It's crazy. Mm-hmm.
I think a few of them. And that's weird. That's super messed up.
You're fucking old, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, apparently.
Old balls. Look at you.
So you think there's a few of them?
I think we live in a time where old people have never been so young.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
And young people have never felt so old. Like, the difference between, we're older millennials, the difference between our part of the millennial generation and the younger millennial generation, it's huge. Huge.
Why aren't millennials saving money? That was the title of something I saw. I want to kick it. Whoever wrote that, I want
to
kick you
in the dick. Well, they have to make it first.
Yeah.
I mean, that would be the first
thing.
Why
aren't they saving money? Spending it on staying alive. With functioning
Why
organs.
Aren't boomers retiring at the same age that their parents
Yeah,
did?
You dicks. Anyway, sorry.
Anyway.
smiling at the camera that's not on because Jesse's changing the battery. Are we done?
Are we done?
This drive's going to take fucking forever.
Jesse, okay. Get another question.
Jesse has one more question.
It's so great when we've got all the time in the world. We can
Have you ever shaved your ass? Well, we already got to that one, so. Oh, yeah. You guys don't care. Oh, nope. So you have to come downstairs with me.
Mm-hmm. Which team that's underperforming now will heat up and make the playoffs?
Ooh. Oh, so the Islanders annoy me a little bit because they remind me a little bit of when Montreal got... when Montreal did so poorly that they got Alex Galchenyuk.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And because the Habs were bad 1 year, now they just have Alex Galchenyuk.
Yeah.
Hmm. Pisses me off. Anyway. And in a couple years, that'll be Sergachev. I think Buffalo is better than second last in the East.
I'm going to say Florida.
They're getting Eichel back.
Florida.
Yeah, Florida for sure. But again, they're 2 points out.
Also the Leafs.
Oh, Nashville.
Oh, yeah.
Are the Leafs underperforming, though? Or are they?
I think they're just performing.
I think they're performing where they're at now.
Roughly.
Which is pretty damn good.
Mm-hmm.
But the problem with it is it doesn't look good when you look at the overall standings because you look at their last 10, looks great. Mm-hmm. You look at the full 20, it doesn't look so great because they didn't start great.
So Dallas is in the final wild card spot in the West with 24 points in 23 games. Predators have played 2 fewer games and they have 23 points. So they're 1 point back of that final wild card spot. And in their last 10 games, they are 7-3-0. They're one of the hottest teams in the league, as a matter of fact.
Wow.
So look for the Preds.
Well, it was only a matter of time.
Actually, looking around the league, there's only one team hotter than the Preds right now. Can you guess who that team is?
Montreal.
It is not. They are 6-3-1. So they're close. They're one of the hotter teams. But there is a team that is 7-2-1 in their last 10.
Toronto?
Same division as Montreal.
Toronto?
Ottawa?
New York.
Ottawa.
Oh.
The Ottawa Senators are the hottest team in the NHL.
Wow.
What the fuck?
I wanted it to be Toronto. I kind of knew it wasn't. Our news can't be that good.
No, yeah.
No, no.
Buffalo, meanwhile, looks like the coldest.
Well, this looks like this is probably the longest podcast in a while. In a while.
I know. I gotta go.
I'm glad we did it.
I gotta go. This is gonna take forever.
We're gonna take a real long time wrapping up the show here. Hope you have a great day. Sorry about the visual with the booty. We will see you Thursday. We'll talk Thursday. And then remember, Monday show, Chris Johnson at Report Chris.
We will Doug Sifu Thursday.
I would like to Doug Sifu if he'll come on. See who the future to see foo. Sorry,
perhaps we'll have some seafood when we see that foo. It's like
we could have ended it right there. No, you're gonna keep talking. No,
go shave your ass.
Follow the guys on Twitter at Steve_Dangle, at AdamWylde, and at Jesse Blake.
The Steve Dangle Podcast. Brought to you by Panago Pizza. Order at Panago.com and stuff your face with deliciousness.